Hello and welcome to another episode of Video Game Logic. Today's show was recorded on April the 11th, 2016. I'm your host, gaming psychologist, and with me as always, my washing machine of a co-host.
Caffeine rage. What does that even mean?
I just pulled that straight out of my ass based on what's going to be the outtake. So if you want to know the answer to that, go to the outtakes. On today's episode, we are going to, of course, be discussing the games we played. I saw Hardcore Henry, and I want to talk about it. We're going to talk about the winners of the BAFTAs. We'll have our community corner and our Steam Weekly Deals discussion. How are you, Rage?
Doing pretty good. How about you?
I'm okay, coming off of an annoying weekend. So for everybody out there listening, this past weekend, my internet died, and Comcast couldn't fix the problem for almost 3 days. So I was left out in the forest with the trees and nature and TV shows and old DVDs. It was a very sad time indeed.
Out with the trees and DVDs.
Yeah, so that's why, I suppose you're listening to this on Friday, but that's why last weekend no videos came out on my channel. Everything was late, and it's probably still getting caught up.
Oh, so you're blaming the internet now.
Well, I'm always a little bit late, but I'm extra late because I haven't had a chance to fix it yet. My internet was working this morning, and of course I had to get up and get ready and leave and go do clients, and now we're recording because, you know.
Oh, so it's my fault.
No.
It's Comcast's fault.
It is.
They know how to throw a wrench into a very busy and fun weekend.
Yep. Fuck Comcast. Fuck them.
Well, if you're into that sort of thing.
If there was any other decent option where I lived, I would drop Comcast in a heartbeat. I would pay more money and receive slower internet as long as it was, you know, good enough to get away from Comcast. But there's not. The only other option I have in my area is HughesNet. And compared to Comcast, well, they make Comcast look like a halfway decent company.
Damn.
HughesNet's really bad.
What do they have for internet? They just bring a string to your house and pull it real tight?
It's satellite internet, which means that, there's, you know, every time there's a cloud in the sky, you get disrupted, and they're very expensive, and they have really low data caps. Like, the maximum plan you can get is 40 gigs a month.
Wow.
I'd burn up 40 gigs in a night. Easy. So, they're not an option, and they're twice as expensive.
Yeah, I think I'd burn 40 gigs a month just on my podcasts.
Yeah. So, they are not an option. But I suppose in the wake of that, I do have some different gaming experiences than I usually have. So I've got some of the same games to talk about, but I've spent tons and tons of time with them instead of just like an hour here, an hour there. So, I've got a different gaming experience to talk about. So, that's a bonus, I guess.
Oh, silver lining. Silver lining.
Yeah, silver lining. There we go.
Yeah, and I've got a few games to talk about. Most of what I played this past week was trying to figure out what the hell to play on the channel because I finished up a series, so that means I have to go through the choosing once again.
The choosing.
There could be only one game that I play for that series slot. But some of them... well, let's go ahead and jump right into it. Because one of them, it was a perspective game for a slot. But I decided that it didn't fit the channel.
Okay.
Far Cry 3.
Oh, yeah. I remember you talking about this earlier.
Yeah, the primary reason why I'm not playing it on my channel is just because of performance issues. It doesn't run terribly. But in some areas, the frame rate drops low enough that the added tax on actually recording drops it down to levels that I'm not comfortable with on recording. So that's the primary reason. Also, it's more of a dicking around game than anything else, to be perfectly frank. Far Cry is more just go shoot animals for a few days. of game time, and that's about it, to be perfectly honest.
Peter would have your ass for that one.
Well, Peter would have my ass because I had a cheeseburger.
Fair play.
I mean, they would get me on both oppressing the cow by milking it for the cheese and then murdering it to get the burger.
Oh, I had a cheeseburger for dinner.
Mmm, cheeseburger. French delicious. Fries or onion rings?
Curly fries.
Well, I'm saying, which is your preference?
Tater tots.
Oh, tater tot man.
Yep. Give me tots any day.
Bold choice.
It's tots.
Or is that just the fact that you have a 2-year-old running around?
No, I've always been that way. I can't use him as an excuse. I've always preferred tater tots to fries.
Yeah, but now he is an excuse because it's a lot easier.
Yeah, it's easier for me to get them. No, it's tots, then curly fries, then regular fries, and onion rings are at the bottom. They're not bad, but typically I have to be in the mood for onion rings, and I'll pretty much always take fries.
I would say curly fries at the top for me. Then I'm going to go off the beaten path and say steak fries.
Ooh, steak fries. Good choice.
Then going down the fry hierarchy, the more McDonald's style, you know, thin crispy fry, you know, the julienne fry.
Yeah. Yeah.
With onion rings at the bottom and tater tots, I would have to probably put between or right at the same level as the thin crispy fries.
Right.
But the curly fries and the steak fries have to be seasoned. They can't just be plain fries.
Well, I mean, I always season fries. And curly fries...
Well, I'm not talking about, you know, salt. I'm talking about, you know, seasoning.
No. I get what you're saying. Curly fries, though, always seem to come with, like, curly fry seasoning. I mean, I don't know what it is, but just curly fries naturally have a flavor to them that regular fries don't. Well,
it's the machine that calls them to curl also... adds the seasoning automatically. It comes with the machine. They can't turn it off.
Oh, if only that's how it actually worked. I'd make perfect curly fries all the time. Because I've actually got like a little thing, and you put a potato on it, and it's got a crank, and you crank it, and it makes curly fries, and you just choose the length of the fries, and you cut them.
I'm sure a certain astronaut would have loved to have that on Mars.
I'm sure he would have. Oh...
But shall we get back to Far Cry 3 now?
Right. Welcome to Video Game Logic, where we occasionally talk about things that aren't video games, like curly fries.
We do our Podfather proud, don't we?
Indeed we do. So yeah, back to Far Cry 3. Continue.
Far Cry 3 is really just dicking around with... There is a story there, but it's so interspaced between just all the dicking around and having to do random Ubisoft bullshit...
Right.
it doesn't feel connected, to be perfectly honest. Because in order to have more than one gun, which in Far Cry, you definitely want more than one gun because for one, your starting ammo pool is just pathetic. And it gives you more options. If you have only a sniper rifle, if something comes up close, you're kind of screwed. So you have to go hunt... bears and take their testicles to make a pouch for that.
Get some bear asses and then use that to make yourself a pouch so you can carry some more ammo. And then go get some elk ass and use that to make a sling to carry another weapon.
And then you have to go make a thong out of deer tongue to get some more health.
Ew. Gross.
Wait, did I step over a line?
I don't know, that's weird. I don't know why, but that one just made me feel like, ew. And I've eaten animal tongue before. Maybe that's why it's weird. I don't know. Like, I just know what tongue feels like when you cook it and then eat it.
Well, the entire system is weird where it's certain animals to do certain things.
Right. It's like my bear asses aren't good enough to make a weapon sling out of. Those can only be ammo pouches.
Yeah, or even better than that. They separate ammo and fuel. So if you have a flamethrower, it doesn't count the ammo. It counts as a fuel pouch. So you have to have a separate thing for that. Then you have to take the correspondence course to have the fourth weapon slot. And if you complete all the tests, and after 6 weeks, and if you spend the actual time to complete your training and send in the nominal fee, you get the fourth weapon slot. Oh, and don't forget, you have to climb all the radio towers.
Right, of course, this is a Ubisoft game. Climb those towers.
It just wasn't a fit for my channel, so I decided to just play it on and off as just a dicking around game. Basically, taking my spotlight, Just Cause 2 is for me, where I just fire it up occasionally and just dick around with it. It's not a terrible game. It seems like any settings I throw at it, its frame rate is all over the place. Like, they didn't do proper level detail.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if it's just my old machine showing its age,
No,
or if
I've
it's
got
just
problems
Warcry
running it
3
too.
itself.
I've got problems running it too. I've played Far Cry 3 on console and on PC, and while it does run better on PC than console, it's all over the place. All over the place. I could not for the life of me get it to run much better than 60, despite what I did to the graphic settings. Maybe if
Oh,
I
it
just.
seems like any preset I throw at it, it doesn't change the fact on how it runs at all. And I know I'm not CPU bottlenecked on it. I checked.
Yeah. Maybe if I just had more raw horsepower, I could have ran it better. But, like, no amount of optimization could get me a stable 60 frame rate. And it's not like I couldn't even hit 60. It would jump wildly for no apparent reason, like, just sitting still or, like, just barely moving the camera from, like, 75 to 30 and, like, just back
Yeah.
and forth. And I'm like, what in the world is going on? So I just gave up. I couldn't take it. I gave up trying to play it on PC.
Well, I can't play it on console because I suck at console shooters.
Right.
I mean, you've seen me try to play a shooter with a gamepad. It's
Yeah.
a sight to behold.
It ain't pretty.
But if I could get over the performance issues, it's not a bad game to be dicking around with because they throw. Well, let's just put it this way: you bring up the map, and there's all sorts of things to go do, which is something that I like. Just a lot of options to play.
Right.
But at the same time, it breaks up the main story so much, especially whenever you have to go a quarter of the way across a fairly decently sized map to get to the next story mission. It's kind of off-putting to do it as a actual series. And that's pretty much all I have to say about Far Cry 3. I only played it for a few hours, so it's barely scratching the surface. I ended up spending a lot of time trying to take out this one outpost, but it was off on this rocky outcrop, so I probably need to come back whenever I have better weapons, which means going to do more radio towers. Because oh, that is something that kind of pisses me off, is that sure, you could buy the weapons, but if you go do the radio towers instead, they give you the weapons. So it's kind of pointless. The only thing that you really spend money on is the attachments for the weapons or the ammo, which you burn through ammo so damn quickly, and the enemies don't drop that much. You have to go do alternate out activities in order to get the money to get the ammo to kill the enemies to take the outpost, then do the radio towers, and it's just a cycle. It's not something I'd want to play for hours and hours on end.
Just use some bait, lure a big ass tiger into the base, hide, and profit.
Yeah, that's probably it. And but the one outpost I was trying to take didn't have an animal cage, or
Well, I
one
mean,
that I could see.
you can lure animals from the wild
I don't
into.
have the access to the bait yet because I haven't unlocked enough radio towers.
Ah, I
Or
see.
whatever the hell unlocks it. Most likely radio towers. I mean, let's be perfectly honest.
Climb some radio towers and get some bear asses.
Why would a bear ass be at the top of a radio tower unless I'm the bear ass mooning the guys?
Who knows, man? It's a Ubisoft game. Everything's at the top of those towers.
I'm pretty sure in Far Cry Primal that you invent a radio tower to climb it.
Ugh, build tower. Ugh, now climb tower. See world. Get bear ass. Which getting a bear ass kind of makes a little more sense in Far Cry Primal, but whatever.
It just comes down to the whole segregation of the different leathers, because let's be perfectly honest, that's what they are. It's different types of leather for the different types of pouches. And why? Outside of just, you know, killing Tom.
Why not?
That's... because people accept it. I mean, we're on how many Far Cry titles have done this?
Oh, several.
I mean, it's at least three, because three did it, four did it, because four is pretty much a carbon copy of three, only a different setting, and Primal's a different time period than four. But it has to pretty much the same map as four.
Yeah. Far Cry 2 did not. Far Cry 2, the only thing you had to collect, you could get, you got cash, and you got diamonds. And you got the diamonds.
Ooh,
and
diamonds.
The diamonds you use to get everything in the game. All the weapons.
Are they a girl's best friend?
They are a girl's best friend. You use those to get everything in the game that was of worth. You know, like the money was used to get ammo and stuff, but otherwise you use diamonds for everything. It was nice and simple, and it made sense thematically. So, no collecting bear asses.
Yeah, but that's pretty much my experience with Far Cry 3 so far. Maybe I'll go back to it. I still need to go back to Civ, by the way.
Yes, you do?
Yes. Sorry, no Civ talk this week outside of saying that I need to go play Civ. Ugh. But I haven't had pretty much an evening I need to forfeit.
Right. So, what other games have you been playing this week?
Okay, well, the next two are from the YouTube channel, Gaming with Caffeine Rage. One is a Let's Play series, and one was the Sunday Sampler. Let's go ahead and do the Let's Play series. Okay. This is one I know you haven't heard of. Okay. If you have, I'll be shocked. And it's kind of funny that we were talking about Far Cry Primal, because this is Stone Tales. I'll give you a moment to look that up.
Yeah, I've never heard of that before. You are correct. Is it a Steam game?
Yeah.
Okay.
Both of these are Steam games.
Tales.
Yeah, this is a action platformer. The interesting thing about it is that the art style is based on cave paintings.
I've seen this before. It's also on my not interested list because it's a platformer, a 2D platformer.
Yeah, well, it looked interesting enough to me, and I did get a review copy for it, so I thought, you know, why the hell not? Because I have another project I want to work on, but I needed a spacer for that time slot, so, you know, a short platformer would be good.
Right.
This isn't a great platformer.
Isn't a great platformer. Okay.
The main problem I have with it is, you're going to laugh at the word I'm going to choose, it's primitive.
Yeah.
Okay. Give you an idea, it has no sound effects. It only has music playing. So there's no like little jump sound. There's no like particle effects whenever you're jumping, you know, like most platformers do. There's no sound effects when enemies die. There's no collectibles in the levels. It's just literally get to the end of the level. It feels more like a beta test than an actual release, if that makes any sense.
Yeah. I was going to say that sounds lazy. I suppose that you could make the argument that it's thematic, like, oh, there's supposed to be cave paintings. Obviously, there's no sound, but...
yeah.
I mean, that feels super lazy for a game, because sound design is hugely important for games.
Yeah, and it didn't really strike me until, like, an hour into the game, you know, what was kind of putting me off on it, because it, you know, it was kind of weird. And right. It's taking the Tales of Two Sons approach, where you're controlling two characters at once. But the thing is that it's not really doing anything with that idea. Brothers, A Tale of Two Sons... did a lot with controlling two independent characters at the same time through puzzles and other means.
Right.
This, it feels more like an inconvenience that you're having to press two jump buttons at once.
It's interesting.
Yeah, unless it changes very late in the game, there is no reason for them to be two separate characters, because you literally want them as close together as possible, unless they're separated by a story method. But then you're still controlling one character, and it's exactly the same, only, you know, you're not pressing the second jump button. One throws a spear, and one has a shield that he blocks with. It's one hit kill, and either brother dies, you restart from the last checkpoint, or the beginning of the level, whatever is furthest in the level, of course. Oh, and that's something else, is that Another reason why I say this feels like a beta test rather than an actual release is that whenever you die and you go back to a checkpoint, what happens is that the camera will load up on the beginning of the level and then quickly snap to the checkpoint.
Right, okay.
So it feels very unfinished.
I feel like that would be really disorienting.
Oh, it is. Especially if you die very close to the checkpoint, so you're doing it several times. And it's just the little things. You know, no collectibles, so... It feels weird to complain about no collectibles in a platformer just because it is such a standard trope. But there's really no reason to take alternate paths, which it does offer occasionally. Other than just added challenge, because some of the paths are tougher than the others. The brother that throws the spear, it feels wildly inconsistent on where he's throwing it. Because it's thrown with the left mouse button. You hold it down and you have the little charging bar. But if you tap it, he'll throw it a little ways, but if you tap it again, he'll throw it, quite a bit. So it feels like a guessing game on just, how far he's going to throw it. A small line that shows where he's going to throw would have been so much better, especially hitting some of the moving enemies.
Right.
Which there are a lot of moving enemies, and also a lot of naked cavemen.
Nice. Nudity builds community.
Oh, well, there's an entire community of naked cavemen that you encounter in, I think it's like the second or third level.
That sounds amazing.
Yeah, it suddenly went on your wish list, huh?
No, not really. It sounds like a really bad game. Naked cavemen is not enough to...
I won't say it's a bad game. I'm going to call it a mediocre game. It's not something I would suggest wasting money on. But it's not so atrocious that I say that it's a never buy. Maybe, on sale if you're hard up for a platformer or you like the art style, it's definitely not worth it's not bad to check out. Or if you just want to check it on my YouTube channel and see what I think about it and hear me cuss, because it is a little frustrating just because it has this weird jumping system, because it has the two characters controlled independently except for the movement keys. And who knows, maybe I'm missing something, because they throw you in the tutorial and they say, okay, here's your brother Ugg, and here's, Unga and Bunga.
Are you serious?
That's the character's name,
yeah. Oh my god, Unga Bunga.
Yeah.
Wow. That's brilliant. All right, it's working its way up the list a little bit.
And also, there's no voice in it, but it has, the broken caveman English for text. Like We Mighty Warriors talking about the tribe. And you get to hear me try to say speak this, by the way, in the channel. It just feels so unfinished. I think that's the best way to say it. If they put a little bit more polish on it, it would have been an amazing platformer.
Because of just, like, the neat art style and stuff?
Yeah, the neat art style. Because I haven't seen a game that takes cave paintings as its art style for the entire thing. Have you?
No, I've never seen that before, I don't think.
Yeah, me either. Oh, so it's a unique art style. But that's pretty much where all their creativity ended, which it's just a shame.
Right. Yeah, that is sad. Because it's very... Lots and lots of games say, we have a unique art style, but it's extremely rare to actually get a game with a unique art style. So,
or have a game with a unique art style that has something beyond just, hey, we have a unique art style.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's kind of sad that they just couldn't deliver on anything else.
Yeah, I think I'm about halfway through the game after one recording session. I did 3 videos on it so far. So, depending on the difficulty ramp up, I'm probably looking at about 2.5 hours of gameplay.
Okay.
Which, that makes it very short for... What was the price on it? I can't remember.
I already...
And you have the store page, don't you?
I navigated away. No, I didn't. $5.99. So $6. $5.99.
So it's not terrible, but at the same time, it's not the greatest price for that short a game.
Right.
And this is rated very positively, by the way, but it's only 19 ratings, so... Yeah, it's kind of suspect there, isn't it?
Yeah, that is pretty suspect. Like, I don't want to say that the dev was like, yeah, hey, friends, go review this game positively, but maybe.
Maybe. Maybe.
Maybe.
Oh, and no controller support, by the way. It's all keyboard and mouse, which just feels so weird for a platformer to have no controller support whatsoever. It's laziness.
So, did you have one more game? Was that your second game?
Yeah, I have one more game.
What's your third
game? This one is also one that I didn't care much for. This was the Sunday sampler for the past week. Bunker Punks.
Okay, Bunker Punks.
Yeah, you're quickly looking that one up because I'd be shocked if you knew that one either.
Well, we've talked about it briefly before, so I am aware of it, but outside of just the, I don't know, maybe the 5-minute conversation we had, I didn't know anything about it.
Oh, well, this is also an early access game, so my primary complaint about it may be fixed just as it goes through the early access process, I should say, is that it just feels like you have to go through an immense grind to have any beat on the gameplay. During my hour, well, actually, I played it for about 2 hours on the Sunday sampler because I also had a video corrupt on this on the game. I don't think it was the game's fault. I think it was my recording program. But I happened to play a very generic shooter for 2 hours. Didn't exactly put me in the best of moods for it.
Right.
I think the biggest crime it has is that the game, the gunplay is just so bland. All the weapons, they're bounced around their rate of fire. There's no clips whatsoever, which just feels weird. In the entire video, I was constantly hitting R because, you know, after, I want to say like 15 or 20 years of playing first-person shooters, you get that training that, you know, you reload whenever there's downtime. I think that's pretty much a standard, right?
Yeah, pretty much.
Unless you're playing some sort of super realistic game which doesn't have the endless ammo pool and it's controlled by clip or size. You know, something like SWAT or infantry. Where it's your ammo isn't a number, it's a number of, well, I shouldn't say a number of bullets, but it's a number of clips that you have. Having that mechanic taken away and then bouncing around rate of fire just makes it feel so off. Having a pistol that I'm sitting there shooting, and my clip size is essentially 50 shots. It's just strange. And also, the animations felt really off. The one melee weapon, I should say that in my 2 hours of gameplay, I encountered 5 weapons. And essentially, outside of, well, the melee is obviously different because you have to walk up to something and bash it on the head. And this is a, well, I should say what the genre of this is. I haven't said that yet, have I? It's a roguelite first-person shooter.
Yeah.
And the store page would make you think that it has some management elements in it, but it doesn't. It has the bunker that you're a punk of.
Yeah, one of the store images or one of the images on the store is it's like a little buy menu. It's like bunker, punk, weapon. Like you can buy one of them.
Yeah, it makes it look like it's some sort of management game, but it's not. Think of it as like the castle in Rogue Legacy, where as you're building up the bunker, you're giving buffs to yourself. So it's not quite a management game. I mean, it is kinda, depending on your definition of management. But it's more just picking what buffs you want instead. But getting back to the gameplay, or to the gunplay, I should say, is that the gunplay just felt so bland because of that clip size. And running up and bashing something on the head melee-wise, yeah, it's just a death sentence and a Doom-inspired or, Doom or Wolfenstein-inspired, almost bullet-hellish first-person shooter. I'm talking the 90s-era shooter where there's just a ton of gunfire coming at you.
Yeah. I'm watching the trailers, by the way, that are on Steam while you're talking. And yeah. I, like, immediately can call out a whole bunch of problems with this game without even playing it.
Oh, really? What do you see?
Well, the weapons are very boring looking. Like, it looks just like standard rifle, standard shotgun, standard pistol, weird sword thing. There's no real animation to the weapons. It's yeah, like they shoot and they kind of like bounce back off screen, which I guess is supposed to be recoil.
Yeah, oh, there's no recoil in this game. Well, I shouldn't say that. There's one weapon that I encountered out of the five that had recoil. It was the rocket launcher, and it bounced you backwards a little bit. Just enough to make it so that your shot would hit the corner that you're trying to shoot around and cause you to blow yourself up.
Right. But so it looks like that the weapon animations are very, very lazy. And even in Doom, there was still animation on all the weapons whenever they fired and whenever you reloaded them. So there's that.
Well, see, the thing is that Doom had reloading.
Yeah. The game looks incredibly repetitive and boring.
Well, it's a roguelite shooter, so all the rooms are going to look pretty much the same. I played... it comes up after you... Well, whenever you start a new game, you're immediately thrown into a... escape mission. Well, all of them are technically escapes. You're just going through these towers, shooting up the various floors and getting to the elevator to go up the next floor or down the next floor. I don't know. It doesn't matter. And as you progress, the towers get taller and taller. So at first it's two, then three, then four, then eventually you get to five and six towers, and that's the end of the world map. And it has this FTL almost world map where instead of having something chasing you, you're able to just freely go around and clear all the towers because, you know, why have urgency into this, I guess?
Enemies are also really bland looking. There's a couple of neat looking ones in the trailer, but for the most part, it's like robot tank, mech,
yeah,
generic flying enemy.
Yeah, I encountered turret with two guns on it.
Oh, damn.
Flying enemy. A flying enemy that has wings thingies that instead of trying to come up next to me and blow itself up, shot at me instead. Android looking thing, or block a bunch of pixels that's supposed to be an android, I think. And that's really about it. I don't think I encountered a human enemy in the lot.
The spider.
Oh, there
tank
was some sort of charger
cool.
thing that was interesting, and it took a lot of bullets to kill. But, you know, I encountered that only on the third tier of levels.
Yeah. The spider tank looks pretty cool, from the trailer.
But yeah, I didn't encounter that.
Even that honestly looks kind of generic. Like, it reminds me of the... shoot, what is it from... Is it Mad Cat from... damn it. MechWarrior, from MechWarrior. That's what it reminds me of, except with four legs instead of two.
I didn't draw that conclusion. But then again, I don't think I looked at the trailer. This is also another review copy.
Well, I've watched this trailer now like six times while you're talking.
Well, you were talking about the weapon animations. That was actually one of my complaints about the melee weapon, because I was trying to use it on some of the enemies. And it was really hard to tell when it was ready to be able to dive back in for another swing. Because you'd do this little wussy swing, and then it'd return to its start position, but it wouldn't be ready for another 2 or 3 seconds. It was just enough to really throw you off.
Yeah, the sword looks lackluster. Because there's like one shot in the trailer of him swinging the sword. And it's like, eh. Like, that's what I imagine. Like, some anemic kid, like... You get away
Poke.
From me.
Yeah, the animations are really lackluster. It doesn't have a map at all. Which, with procedural generation, it makes it very easy to get turned around in. At one point, I actually ended up going all the way back to the start. Because I just got turned around. Because in the style of shooter, you're constantly moving around in circle strafing. So it's very easy to lose your way.
Do enemies respawn, or when you clear them, are they gone?
Once you clear the room, we mentioned the enemies being rather generic. Another thing that I didn't capture it in the second video that I had to do with it because the first one corrupted. But on the first video, I actually had several times that the enemies would be sitting at a door waiting for me to open it. And as soon as the door opened, the enemies blew themselves up and took, and I took unavoidable damage. Which is just a dick move. A roguelite game, in my opinion, to be fair, if you are skilled enough, you should be able to get through a level without taking a single point of damage. Now, I'm not saying that it has to be to the point where I could get through a level without taking a single point of damage, but someone that is significantly skilled should be able to do that game with a damageless run. And there was just times that enemies would be hiding around a corner, like a little nook next to a door. You'd pop in, check the left and right on the door, not see anyone, start fighting the enemies, and the enemy would come up behind you and blow itself up, you know, hiding on you. And since you don't have a map, you can't see that there's a nook there. It's just little things like that. Having enemies waiting at the door to blow themselves up. There were several times that turrets would shoot down a corridor that there was no way to dodge. Because they had a long enough line of sight that they would get me about halfway down the corridor. And I can't back off quickly enough. And I couldn't see them because they were behind something. Or there was another enemy in front of them. Oh, it's just all sorts of problems. A lot of this could be addressed in early access, though. I do want to make that point. Oh, and also, one last thing is that there looks like there's more content there than what I encountered. You know, at least having guns. The ammo, or not the ammo, the armor drops is interesting. Because you get four armor slots. And all of them offer different bonuses. You know, like you may get a hat that increases your pistol damage for who knows what reason.
A hat that increases your pistol damage. Okay.
I'm not joking there. Got a hard hat that increased pistol and rifle damage, I believe.
Made out of the right kind of bear ass, that hat. Bringing it back around.
But getting back on topic, there's just so few drops that, you know, I was encountering the same drops over and over again. But after the run is complete, you get tech points. Or they rarely drop during the level. So you'll pick up one, and it'll be 15 points. And then after the run is done, after you die, because let's be honest, you're not going to have enough stuff unlocked to be able to do the first run. And also, the game is cheap enough that they'll do, you know, damage that you can't avoid. And there's... I didn't encounter a boss now that I think about it.
You did?
So I'm not sure if there's going to be bosses at all.
Didn't. Okay.
Did not.
Okay.
I didn't encounter anything that could even be considered a boss outside of maybe that one charging enemy. But it just charged down the corridor and I launched a couple of rockets at it and killed it. After the run is done, you're taken to the caravan, which is at first one guy in a Mad Max style vehicle, and you're given three options to buy stuff, and he restocks as you buy stuff. And that's your unlock system, is that, you know, you're given, you could have another bunker slot, so you could have a second bunker punk. Let's see, what was my options on the first run? It was a bunker slot that was actually free, so it gave me the second... each punk, by the way, it works independently. So it's essentially a life system, which each one has different attributes, different amounts of life, armor, that sort of thing, their speed. So that's kind of interesting, and you're given a two to start with, and then others unlock as you buy them through tech points. Which is kind of boring. I would have much rather seen, you know, perform a certain action and unlock a punk. But my initial unlock was a bunker slot, a punk, and I think a weapon. Which I'm not sure if the weapons, once you unlock them, has a chance to drop, or if they just appear in your bunker and after that initial mission, you're given an option to take them with you. But even that point, the weapon I was given a choice of was a revolver. But without a clip size, all the revolver becomes is an upgrade to the pistol because the revolver has more damage. And typically, revolvers are balanced around a smaller clip size, right?
Normally, yeah. More powerful, smaller clips.
Yeah. But without that reload, they have to balance it around it being a slower and fire weapon. And the pistol already fires fairly slowly. So I don't know what they would try to balance around. It feels like a flawed game. There's good ideas there, but unfortunately, I'm not going to say that they're not skilled enough to pull it off, but they have a long ways to go if they want to get through the early access system and make a good game coming out the other side.
Right.
And I should say that this is all based on stuff that are that's from the initial release on early access. So anything that they change in the future may change or negate all my criticism of it.
Right. That is the nature of early access games. Sometimes they change everything.
Yep.
So, I mean, it is possible that they could put in more animations or new animations or whatever for weapons and add some more enemy types and et cetera, et cetera. But, you know, at this point, that is your criticism.
At this point, it's just such a grind to get to any other content that I would say go play Ziggurat, go play Tower of Guns. I'm trying to think of other first-person... Paranormal Activity. That's another good one. That's three that I could think of right off the bat that I would say go play that rather than this.
Right.
Unless you really want the 90s-style FPS aesthetic.
Which, if that's the case, just go play Doom. You can get them for free. They're open source now. You can get Doom 1 and 2 for free without having to actually pirate them. They're legitimately open source. You can do that with Marathon as well. You can get the first two Marathon games that way. So, there you go.
So, I think that brings us around to you.
My turn.
Yeah, I think I went a little long on my rants.
You did. We're at like 45 minutes-ish.
Drink.
Yeah, it's not that... sure, I'll take a drink of water. Actually, I am kind of thirsty. I've blown through most of my cup of water.
Wow.
So we'll probably have to take a short break so I can get some more water after I discuss my drink. Games. Drink. I suppose the people at home could play along every week if they wanted to. So, there you go. If you're playing along at home, take a
We're
drink.
We're sorry.
Take a drink. Take a shot. Take all kinds of stuff. My first game on the list is KSP again this week. Just before my internet died on Thursday, there was another an update that released for the 1.1 pre-release that fixed my crashing issues. So I went into the weekend with a stable version of Kerbal Space Program.
Woo.
And I probably played KSP for 20 hours over the course of the last 3 days. And just generally had a good time with it. I mean, there's not really much to say. I started a new career and basically have been playing through. I've gotten all the way to Duna with probes and stuff, working my way up the tech tree and earning money and such. But the game is not crashing every 20 minutes now. In fact, the entire time I played it, it didn't crash once. So, hooray. And also, it was running at a pretty stable 60 FPS. I had a dip here or there. But for the most part, it ran at 60 or very near 60.
Yeah, it's they've done a lot on the performance side of things.
Yes, it's magical. I'm so happy. Actually, KSP runs better on my laptop now because even though the i5 in my desktop is a more modern processor, its clock speed is a little bit slower than the i7 that's in my laptop.
Mm-hmm.
And with the graphics settings set the same, KSP runs better on my laptop now. Whereas before, my laptop could not run KSP for anything. So that's amazing to me. And good job, Squad. And that's really all I have to say about it. We talked about it at length last week, and nothing else has changed. Just, it worked for me. It was not broken. I also played Clash Royale this weekend. I got to the fifth arena. And was there for a while, and before getting knocked back to the fourth arena, I kind of plateaued. I was stuck at around 1,500 trophies, which is the fifth arena is 1,400 trophies. So I was just past being in it, And I was stuck. I was pretty much at a 50% win ratio. And I was like, well, I could change my deck up a little bit to incorporate some of these new cards and see how that goes. And that got me killed a lot. So I'm back down in the
fourth. Because they weren't as strong?
Yeah, they weren't as strong. And I also didn't really know how to use them. So I'm back down in the middle of the fourth arena. Going, well, do I keep using this and trying to learn it and perhaps drop even farther? Or do I go back to my old deck, get back up to the fifth arena, and then try again? So, we'll see. I haven't quite decided yet, but basically I went from a deck that really focused on defense to being a deck that focused on overwhelming. So it's not a whole lot of powerful cards, but it's a strength in numbers kind of thing. And I'm encountering a lot of players that I think know that that's a really good way to win at the fifth arena. And they've all got like really simple cards, but that are devastating to large groups of weak.
AoE stuff?
Yeah, like really good AoE stuff that just wrecks
my... So they're playing the meta.
Yeah, they're playing the meta, and I'm trying to without cheat, well, not cheating. I don't think it's cheating to look up the meta, but I enjoy the challenge of figuring out what to do on my own. So I'm going to have to come up with a new deck composition. And I've got a couple of ideas, but I think I'm going to switch back to my old deck, work my way back up to the fifth arena, and then try again with another new deck composition. But if I can get to the fifth arena and stay in the fifth arena for more than... a few rounds, I am going to actually spend some money to get some premium currency so that I can open up chests and get some cards faster. I think all I'm going to do with it is use it to just open the chests that I win for matches so that I can play more.
Yeah, they got you hooked.
They do. They do. I'm very invested in this game. Like I've said before, I feel like it's a very balanced game. It's very difficult to buy power. There are a few circumstances where I would consider someone has bought power, but generally, if you spend a bunch of money and get a bunch of cards, you very quickly outpace the players around you, get bumped up to the next tier, and then, you know, those players don't see you anymore. So unless you purposefully derank yourself by losing matches, then you... But, I mean, anyone could do that. I could purposefully derank myself all the way back down to Arena 1 with all of my really powerful Arena... 4 and 5 cards and just rape everybody on the way back up.
Yeah, that's something that I've encountered in a lot of games. And it feels like a real design flaw. And I'm not sure how to counteract that. Is that a good way to get currency is to basically throw a lot of matches so that your rank just plummets and then, you know, just hammer away on people as you slowly rank back up.
Yeah, but that's I don't know. It's just not fun to me. I like the challenge of trying to build a deck that can beat other people and win on skill. Most of the people that I encounter have definitely already spent money because most of them, I'm rank 7 or level 7, like Crown Tower 7. Most of the people that I'm fighting are Crown Towers 5 and 6. So either they were good enough to win more of their matches early on or they've spent money.
Yeah.
I've only fought one person who's a higher level than me. So, and I mean, I've just been grinding it out the hard way.
Oh, my. Aw, bumping and grinding.
But that...
Leaning up against that washing machine.
Yeah, I am. And I like it. but that brings me to the game that I've played the most this past week, which is not EVE Online because I didn't have internet. Instead, it's a little mobile game made by a company called Kairosoft, called Skyforce Unite. I brought this game up last week, and I was like, yeah, it's kind of fun. I've played it for a couple hours, and I'm going to have to play it some more. I played it for 18 hours over the weekend.
So, quick question. How many homoerotic volleyball matches have you taken part of over the weekend?
All of them. Okay. When you get a high enough level, you can get someone... Like, you can create a person that's, like, recruited to your team, and, like, you're the team leader, and they're your wingman. And I called my wingman Goose. So, I get the reference.
Oh, just don't get in a flat spin.
I did that in KSP on I accidentally made a really shitty helicopter. I screwed up. I wasn't paying attention, and I accidentally switched one of my engines to reverse thrust because I was playing around with the right click menu, and it put me in a flat spin that I could not recover from, and I crashed because it was a plane, not a helicopter.
Everyone bails, and Bill hits his head on the canopy on the way out.
Nope, we rode it all the way down, though. And somehow the cockpit survived. Everything else, destroyed. Cockpit survived. So,
underwear, total loss.
Jeb made it home. Well, thankfully, he wore the brown pants that day, so nobody noticed.
Well, he has the right idea, at least.
But anyways, back to Skyforce Unite from Kyrosoft. Yeah, I had played it for a couple of hours last week, and I think I said something along the lines of, it's fun, but I can very clearly see where the free-to-play, you know, wanting you to buy currency is going to come in the near future. And I was absolutely right. You're exploring this continent that has appeared, you know, magically in the world. And your first three kind of levels or... not levels, regions of the continent that you unlock are very well balanced in terms of difficulty for the level that you're at. One of them is like this nice pretty plains area, the other one is like a swamp, and then the other one is a volcano, an active volcano.
But the fourth one, that's the danger zone.
The fourth one is the danger zone, and you ride the highway to it.
And here I thought you would just fly.
But so the first three areas are pretty well balanced for your level. And not much real upgrading or investment is required to go through them, which is good because you don't get a lot of money at the beginning. You don't get access to very many aircraft at the beginning. And you don't even get the ability to unlock new aircraft for a long time. You have to be like level 15 before you unlock the lab where you can research new planes. You start basically with World War I era stuff. A lot of biplanes, some weird... prototype planes from like the early 1900s, like the 1910s to 1915, before kind of the standard World War I era biplane came into
being. Taking the Wright Flyer out on a mission.
Actually, there is a plane that looks like the Wright Flyer, and it's a bomber.
Yeah, the wings collapse and the entire thing just goes down.
And that's the bomb. That's kamikaze. But
Bonsai!
But at around level 15, you get a monkey, and yes, he's a monkey, and you use bananas. You pay him in bananas, and there's different, like, classes of bananas that you can unlock. There's green bananas, yellow bananas, and orange bananas so far.
What about bear-ass bananas?
So far, there's no bear-asses, but...
What about Japanese nose bananas? Or did you not see that GIF?
No, I saw that GIF. I had to think about it for just a second. But you pay him in bananas, and he researches new technology for you. And I've slowly been working my way up the tech tree, and I'm at World War II era planes, like early World War II era planes. Like the plane I just unlocked was the Zero, which is a Japanese fighter plane, if you are unaware. And that's a good progression of all real-world aircraft to get to. But you don't even get that stuff to your level 15. You can't get your wingman until you're level 10. And it takes a decent amount of time to get to those things.
It's a hell of a grind.
Yeah, it's a hell of a grind. And after you get through the first three areas, and you unlock the fourth area, which is called the Fort.
Like Fort Get About It?
You might as well Fort Get About It. Because the Fort is fucking difficult. You go from finding like these really funny looking kind of fairy and mythical creatures that are like, oh, well, I'll just shoot these guys with my machine gun, and obviously I will shred them to bits, to fighting anti-aircraft emplacements and rocket trucks and other planes, and it's like, what the fuck happened? And your World War I...
Where's my fantasy creatures that I could easily kill?
Your World War I era stuff just gets murderized. Absolutely destroyed. So I spent, I don't know, 6 or 8 hours... refilling my energy and like doing all these low level missions over and over again to level up and grind out money. It's pretty generous with the free currency or the premium currency that it gives you at the start. And if you only spend it on refilling your energy bar and maybe one like premium aircraft, You can go pretty far in it, but it becomes very apparent that it's like, okay, it wants me to spend money. Now, thankfully, there's a loophole. They just released this thing called the Kairosoft Club, which if you have purchased and or played Kairosoft games in the past, every day you can log in through the Kairosoft Club and claim premium currency in one game. So basically, every day I've just been claiming premium currency in Skyforce Unite, which is helping me a lot. But it definitely is like I hit that point where it's like, okay, I either have to spend money on this game or just spend a ridiculous amount of time grinding it out.
Or join the KK.
Or join the KK. I mean, it's a fun game. I really enjoy it. I love the theme. That's one thing I have to give Kairosoft is they make great themes on games. I still wish I could have just bought it and not had to deal with all this premium mobile bullshit, but the
But
theme.
you're playing on a premium mobile bullshit platform.
Yeah, I know. The theme is good enough, and thankfully, thanks to the Kairosoft Club, it's generous enough with its premium currency that I don't feel compelled to spend any money. Plus, on top of that, I don't feel compelled to spend any money because I've actually bought some Kairosoft games before, which I enjoy. So, I don't know. We'll see. I might spend some money on it if I spend too much more time on it. It's in that weird place where it's like I've been playing it and enjoying it, but at the same time, it has been a real grind, and I feel like I've only gotten maybe half the amount of enjoyment out of it that I would have if it wasn't for the massive grind. So, I don't know. Part of me wants to give them some money just because I've spent so much time in the game, and then part of me is going, well, it's your own damn fault I've spent so much time in the game because you've made it so grindy and difficult and stupid. So we'll see. I will probably keep playing this game and reporting on it into the near future, and bounce back and forth between it and a couple of other mobile games. And then the last game this week, which I barely played, was EVE Online. I had a pretty busy week during the actual week, so I didn't get to play it but for a few hours and do some mining with the corp and stuff like that. And
Yeah,
then
and then you had this busy weekend planned and all.
I had this busy weekend plan where I was going to spend all weekend mining out stuff and then the
And
internet
recording.
and recording. We were going to do a bunch of recording this weekend, but the internet went down, so I didn't play it. But I will give you a quick war report. The Imperium basically disappeared. So last week I was talking about how that they were defending all of these borders like crazy. But kind of overnight, they just up and retreated into their inner walls. And
Okay, why?
I don't know. I have no idea. There's been tons and tons of speculation on the forums and on the subreddit, but they just up and disappeared. And there haven't
That's where they're
been
hiding the catalyst. And
there
those who've read a certain novel know what I'm talking about.
they haven't there have been very few battles over the past week. There's been some skirmishes.
But they just gave up a ton of territory.
Yeah, they did. They gave up a ton of territory. So some of their outlying alliances and corporations that have been holding on to some of that territory still fought to defend it. But for the most part, they just gave up a huge portion of space. And there's a lot of speculation as to why it is. And I think they're not very, or they're not poor tacticians. Goons in particular have come up with several well-used, really successful fleet doctrines and fleet compositions. So they're not stupid. So it could be some kind of tactical play, like they realize that they're outmatched and they're going to have to do something that is very strategically powerful in
So
order
they fell
to.
back to a stronger position.
Right, so they've fallen back to a stronger position. Also, another popular theory is that the goons got beat at their own game, which is they're not having fun playing. And so they've just stopped logging in on the character on those characters and are playing other characters. So it's a toss-up. We still haven't seen a Titan fleet engagement, and I suspect there will be at least one of those, if not just for the sake of it. Like, it's really weird, but in a game, you know, it is still a video game at the end of the day, and people love to fight and blow shit up. So I think that there will be at least one Titan battle just for Titan battle's sake. But it's been really quiet. The subreddit has went from, you know, tons of like war posts and theories and propaganda to back to mostly to normal, where people are just like shitposting funny memes and occasionally disgusting stuff.
It's been a siege instead of a war.
Yeah, it's been a really boring siege, to be honest. There's still been economic gains. There's definitely been economic gains. We made quite a bit of money during the first couple of weeks when the big push was going on. But
yeah, which I imagine most of your gains are still to come whenever they're restocking.
Yeah, most of the gains will be in the aftermath, but you know, it's, I mean, it looks like that this is not the end. I don't think it's the end, but it's just weird. This level of retreat has never happened in EVE before. It's always constant battle, you know, tug of war over a couple of systems until those systems fall. And then typically once those systems fall, like the major ones, one side will push on the other one until they wipe them out. But this has just kind of been this weird stalemate that has just kind of disappeared with a whimper. But like I said, they could be retreating back to a stronger fallback position based on the new sovereignty rules. You know, they're having a harder time holding territories with big fleets than they used to, since now you can win by guerrilla tactics and not having to destroy the main stations in every system.
Yeah, and so, they're just having people slide the blockade and do that instead, right?
Yeah, I mean, that has been happening. So it could be that they are regrouping, trying to figure out a way to combat this because their old fleet doctrines aren't working. But, I mean, it's a toss-up. There have been plenty of goons who have said, other people in the Imperium, not just goons, but plenty of goons that have been like, you know what, this isn't fun. Our leadership has gone to shit. You know, I'm bored, or I'm constantly being berated in chat for whatever reason, I'm done. There has been a lot of that, but
people leaving the goon squad.
Yeah, but goons had over 17,000 members, so mm-hmm. You know, the few that are throwing up their hands and leaving are still a very, very small minority. So we'll see. I mean, I will continue to report on the war as it happens,
or who knows, Hitler may attack Russia in winter.
He might. He was featured on some EVE update that I haven't seen any. Like, I mean, I haven't looked at it yet because my internet was out over the weekend. But they featured him in like a little thing where they were talking about the war, Mitanni. So I did
yeah,
not.
Yeah, if they're going to do a standoff like that, at least start hurling insults at one another.
Oh, they have been doing that. Go check the EVE subreddit. There are a lot of people flinging insults and shit at one another.
Ah, fart in your general direction.
Oh.
You knew I was going to that, right?
I didn't know you were going there, but when you went there, it was so, so sweet. But yeah, that's really all I have on the games that I played this week. Just a shitload of mobile games. Which I usually always have one or two of those, but I mean, my gameplay this weekend was definitely, or this past week was definitely dominated by mobile games.
Gee, I wonder why.
Well, I have to say that mobile games have come a long way. There's still kind of the ass end of many jokes in the gaming community, and they still mm-hmm. represent, for the most part, a business model that I don't agree with. It's psychological manipulative tactics, but the games have come a long way.
Yeah, I think I'm gonna have to get a proper smartphone pretty soon.
Yeah,
I'm gonna have to look at a cheap one
or a tablet. You could get a used iPad for I don't know, $100 or $150.
And well, I need to upgrade my phone anyway, from a dumb phone to something that I could actually type on.
Yeah.
So I think it's going to be probably a cheap Android.
Yeah, there's a lot of those. There's some pretty good cheap Androids as well. And the secondhand market is amazing on Androids.
Yeah.
I'd recommend. I've got a Galaxy Note 3. I've had this phone for nearly 2 years now, and it's not slowing down in terms of performance. It still kicks ass. And its battery life is great. I can play games for like 5 hours straight before it dies.
Yeah, I think I'm going to have to look at the secondhand market probably in the next month or two.
Yeah. And honestly, and, you know, we're, again, getting off the topic of games, but
shocking.
Cell phones, if you're going to buy secondhand, Samsung is one of the best phone makers out there, they're always a generation, at least one generation ahead of the competition, at least in recent history. Mm-hmm. The iPhone and a lot of HTC stuff is just now starting to catch up with what Samsung was doing a couple of years ago. So the Note 3, the Note 4, the Galaxy S4 and the S5, those mm-hmm. are all really affordable smartphones at this point that are, you know, that can keep up with the iPhone 6 and what was the HTC Note 8? I don't, whatever this year's HTC phone was. I think it was like the Note 1 or the Note 8, something like that.
I'll be perfectly frank. I don't know a lot about phones.
Right. Well, when it actually comes time for you to buy one, come talk to me. I've owned a whole bunch of different phones because I get one provided to me for work. And before that, I've bounced around on a lot of different Android phones over the past. I'm not much of an iPhone guy, so if you want to go with an iPhone, the only advice I have for you is...
you know how I love Apple.
I was going to say, if you want to get an iPhone, my only advice for you is don't. And if you do, you're on your own.
Yeah, it's going to be Android something.
Yeah.
Because it seems like Windows phones is a dead end.
Oh, yeah. Windows phones are dead on arrival. They don't get any app support except from Microsoft itself, really. A few third-party developers, but not many. I mean, they're in the position that BlackBerry was a few years ago before they pretty much died. I mean, I do know that BlackBerries are still kicking around in the business world and a few other places. I believe South America has got the largest percentage of BlackBerries per capita compared to the rest, you know, worldwide.
BlackBerries. Oh, sorry, what were we talking about again?
But, yeah, Windows Phone is headed the direction of BlackBerry. Except they're not as good as a BlackBerry, so, yeah.
Yeah, they don't make a good jam.
Touche. But, yeah, those are the games we played this week. On to the news?
Yeah, I think so.
Well, I suppose news and general discussions this week. But before we do that, let's take a quick break so that I can go get some more water. Alrighty, so moving on to Hardcore Henry. I went to go see that this weekend since, I didn't have any internet and Comcast were a bunch of dicks. Went to go see Hardcore Henry on Saturday and holy shit. So, all right.
How spoiler are we going to get?
I will be slightly spoilery, but I will not spoil everything. In order to describe some of the things that happen, I have to spoil bits of the story, but they are the things that I need to talk about to explain what was going on.
But to be fair, it is more of a popcorn movie, right? So it's the story is kind of secondary to the action.
It's difficult. Yeah, in some respects, the story is secondary to the action, but in other respects, it does spend some time really hammering out some story stuff to you. So we'll see how it goes. And if I get way too spoilery, I might cut a couple things out of the discussion. But we'll see.
Yeah, I don't care too much about spoilers myself.
Right. Okay. So Hardcore Henry. For those of you,
for Hardcore Henry, I should say.
for those of you who perhaps missed me talking about it last week, or this is your first time ever listening to the podcast, or whatever, it is an action movie that was shot entirely in first person. There are only two shots in the movie that are not first person.
Was I right on my guess for the second shot, or for the ending?
Sadly, you were not right.
Damn. That would have been so funny, though.
It does have a shot that's kind of like that. Towards the end of the movie, you think that Henry's dead, and he's lying there, and you can just see his reflection in a piece of glass. And the screen starts to fade to red, like it's going to pop up and say wasted. But it doesn't do that. But it kind of teases you. So you were kind of right, but that's not exactly what it does. No, one of the shots is kind of an establishing shot at the beginning of the movie to show something that I don't quite understand how it's related to the story at all in any way. I think maybe like that the kid that it shows is supposed to be the main bad guy, whose name is Akon or Aiken, but it doesn't really make that clear. And then there's another shot that's kind of a sweeping shot of a city, just a generic city with
in the city
that shows this weird little robot thing that, again, doesn't really relate to the story unless it's supposed to be part of what makes Henry a cyborg.
In the city, there's this weird little robot thing, and he does stuff.
So, yeah, those are the only two shots that aren't in first person in the whole movie. Which, if you just took the movie in as a general action movie, kind of a generic action movie, it would be an average action movie with an only slightly convoluted plot and some pretty standard action stuff. But the movie being in first person changes everything. For example, pretty near the beginning of the movie, there's a scene where that Henry is trying to hide from these mercenaries that are chasing him. And he's in a parking lot, you know, hiding between and under cars and stuff like that. You've seen that scene, you know, hundreds of times in other action movies. And
yeah, but you don't know where the bad guys are this time around.
Right, you don't know where the bad guys are. And they use really well put together sound effects and sound design to give you kind of an idea like, oh, there's a bad guy over in this direction. But like, you're in first person, so it's like there's cars over there. You can't see them coming. And like this guy like pops around the corner and sees you, and he's just like a security guard for the car lot. And he gets shot and killed, and Henry's like, oh, fuck. And like, he panics, and like, he, you know, tries to hide under a car, and they spot him. So like, he runs and hides inside of a shipping container with another car inside of it, and like kills a guy that comes in after him, and then sends the car out. Again, like pretty standard action stuff. Like, you've seen that sort of thing before, but it's like just being in first person, it's all incredibly different. Like, it's just a new perspective on the same old things that you've seen before. And it was really, really interesting and made me think really differently about a lot of action movies I've seen before. Then there's some other stuff that normally wouldn't bother me, but was really freaky to see in first person. Like, there's this parkour. Well, there's several parkour scenes in the movie, actually, but there's one in particular where he scales a building, kind of Assassin's Creed style. And, you know, he's scaling a building and jumping, and, like, he slips and almost misses a ledge. And, again, that's something you've seen, like, tons of times in action movies, or not even necessarily action movies, just lots of kind of stealthy movies that employ elements of stealth or whatever. And you're like, oh, the hero almost fell down. They're trying to build some tension. But, like, watching that in first person, it's like, oh, fuck. Like, it actually was really scary a couple of times. And it made my heart, like, race. It made me sit on the edge of my seat. And it's just, like, I know I'm sitting in a movie theater. But they did such a good job of portraying a first-person perspective. It was like, my brain was like, oh, shit, I'm going to fall down. And then I would catch myself, like, oh, yeah, this is a movie. Which, that was amazing. Like, I've watched a lot of movies. I'm a big movie guy. I mentioned last time that I'm a bit of an amateur movie critic, amateur kind of film guy. And I've studied some filmmaking principles and like shot techniques and camera work and things like that, you know, to just kind of on a hobby level. And I've never experienced anything in any movie or anything that I've researched or studied before that made me feel quite this way. So, I mean, in terms of that, it was really well done. Action scenes had a whole new level to them. Not just like the thing in the middle, like kind of in the beginning, the tension being in the car lot, like I mentioned before, but the big kind of be all end all action scene of the movie at the end, where he's having this huge brawl with like 30 or 40 dudes. The best way to, or the best thing I've thought of to compare it to is, you know, that scene from, Matrix Reloaded. I think it's called the Burly Brawl, where he fights like 50 Mr. Smiths in the courtyard.
Mr. Anderson, Mr. Anderson.
Yeah.
Sorry. Have you ever seen the Riff Trax version of, the Matrix movies?
I have not.
Oh, you're in for a treat if you, well, you love all the Matrix movies, so.
I do, but I mean, I like Riff Trax, so.
It is fun. Just that one scene. Every time I think of it now, I think of their riff on it. It's just them repeating Mr. Anderson over and over again as the different Smiths show up. Yeah, and they start giving them names, names as well.
I should go and watch that. But no, the thing I'm trying to the point I'm trying to make is, like, you know that scene where he fights like 50 Mr. Smiths at once.
Yeah, but now, only this would be in first person.
Imagine that in first person. It's fucking insane. But this brings me to the main point that I have a problem with the whole thing, is that I occasionally suffer from motion sickness when I ride in the back seat of a car and I'm already not feeling well, like during allergy season or something like that. I got the worst motion sickness I've ever had in my entire life watching this movie. I got it once in the middle of the movie during one of the earlier action scenes, but it was very mild. Like, just a little bit of, my stomach's a little bit sick, but whatever, that's fine. But the last action scene goes on for like 20 or 25 minutes. And just, I mean, it's crazy because it's in first person. So the camera's swinging around and he's jumping and rolling and fighting. And like, he falls down and like, he's kicked in the face and shoots people. And there's explosions and all kinds of crazy stuff. And I got to feeling awfully sick by the end of that movie. And the credits rolled. I stood up. I thought I was going to throw up. I walked outside into the sunlight and then, like, that was it. I was done. I had to sit down for like 20 minutes until I could recover and drive home. And I'm somebody...
So basically the Blair Witch effect.
Yeah. I mean, I'm somebody with a built-in tolerance to FPS gameplay from being a gamer. I don't normally experience motion sickness. Like, I don't get sick on boats or planes or normally in cars. Like I said, occasionally if I'm riding in the back seat and I already don't feel very well. I don't know what to think of people who don't have that kind of tolerance built up to it if they go see it, or someone who already experiences a bit of motion sickness. I've seen both sides. I've seen reviewers be like, yeah, it was a great movie, but it made me sick as a dog. And I've seen other people going, I don't understand why this makes anybody motion sick. It didn't bother me. So I think that that's kind of a case-by-case basis, but still, the motion sickness sucked. It was a good experience, though. I mean, I would go see it again in a heartbeat. Even knowing that I might experience the exact same thing again. It might not be so bad watching it a second time, but I would still go see it again. In fact, I might do that before I go pick my wife up at the airport tomorrow. outside of that, it was the best video game movie I've ever seen. It has a lot of video game tropes in it, and definitely certain aspects of the game or of the movie were inspired by video games. Like, for example, climbing the building, very clearly inspired by Assassin's Creed. Like, it wasn't even, like... I've watched a lot of parkour videos. It wasn't standard parkour. It was very clearly Assassin's Creed-type climbing. Like, jumping straight up windows and stuff like that. It's got a very video game bad guy who goes over the top and monologues like crazy.
You sly dog.
And the bad guy's... Nice reference, by the way. This is like the reference podcast. And not even like very many hidden references, just blatant references, but they're all over the place. But, and so the bad guy's main shtick is that he's telekinetic. And so like that makes him like a megalomaniac because he thinks that he's like better than everyone else. And makes for some really interesting scenes in the movie. There's like a platforming section at the very end. Like Henry's fighting the main bad guy. He pisses him off, so he's like, I will show you my final form. And he's like exercising all of his telekinetic powers, and he's like floating in midair. And there's a whole like line of bodies that are rising, and Henry runs up the bodies and kills Akon. And it's like, that's definitely platforming. That's very much platforming. So there's, I won't give away everything in the movie because there's a whole lot of stuff that you should really just see to understand. The story, very video game-esque. Like, there's this one character, this is the last thing I'm going to say on it, but there's this one character, his name is Jimmy, and he's the other, like, Henry's the main character, that's the player character. Jimmy is, like, the NPC sidekick that sticks around for the whole movie. And he's very clear, like, he shows up, delivers a bit of dialogue, tells you what to do next, literally gives you a mission marker, like, he gives Henry a phone with, a GPS location on it, it's like, here is where you need to go. Henry goes there, and then Jimmy meets him there and gives him the next mission. And it's great. There's a whole bunch of different Jimmys, and that goes to the story as to why there's a bunch of different Jimmys. But basically, they're clones. Spoiler. but there's a bunch of them. And it's just great. It's great the way that they throw in video game tropes. The best thing in the movie, though, was the ending. Do you mind if I spoil the ending?
No.
Okay, spoiler for the ending. If you don't want to hear the very end of Hardcore Henry, skip ahead like 30 seconds to a minute.
All right.
Okay, so end of the movie, Henry is in this chopper. He's killed Akon, and his wife is there, but she's not really his wife. She's betrayed him, and he's like an experiment.
That bitch.
Yeah, sorry. That bitch. And so she's like, Henry has overcome his like psychological pre-programming, killed Akon, and he beats the shit out of her, and she's hanging on the side of the chopper, and she's like pleading with him, like, Henry, remember, I'm your wife. Please save me. Follow your heart. And Henry looks down at her, and then he looks up, grabs the big sliding door, and slams it down and cuts her fingers off, and she falls to her death.
And then he takes his wedding ring off her finger.
No, it just cuts to black. But that was...
I think that would have been a nice little touch to it, is that at the end, just as it fades to black, he's picking up the finger and just takes the wedding ring off of it and drops it.
Yeah, that actually would have been very good. But no, it was a great ending. It just was a perfect video game ending. Like, fuck you. So, yeah, it was... That's end of spoilers. If you're coming back, no more spoilers from this point on. So yeah, it was a good movie.
It was a sled.
It was a good movie. It was a good time. I don't think that this will become like a gimmick, like how 3D was, but I'm not sure if a whole genre of first person movies will crop up around it. I think the biggest limiting factor is going to be actually how many people experienced motion sickness when they went to see it. If it's a small minority, then I think that it has a shot. But if, say, a third to half of the people who went to see it developed motion sickness watching it, I think we'll see a few more, because this was a really well done movie, but it won't become its own big genre. It'll still be more of a niche thing. But
I have to wonder.
What?
I brought up Blair Witch before. I wonder if, because video games are more out there now, and that first person games are a lot more common for the average person, I should say. You know, gaming has changed a lot since Blair Witch came out. I wonder if that means Hardcore Henry's going to have fewer motion sickness problems, or more, because people are used to controlling the action in a first person perspective.
I don't know. I think that was my biggest problem. I was not in control. So I think that was what gave me the most trouble and gave me motion sickness. So, real quick, I just looked up Box Office Mojo's Hardcore Henry opening weekend figures. Mm-hmm. Movie cost $10 million to make. Opening weekend, it made $7.2 million. So, it didn't clear its budget opening weekend.
Yeah, but not bad.
Right, but it will. It will definitely, by next week, have cleared its budget. For a super niche movie that is...
Very experimental.
Very, very experimental. Not quite one of a kind, but it's the first full-length feat. Well, there have been first-person projects that have been done before, but Hardcore Henry is the first full-length feature film release to be entirely in first-person. There was one indie movie that tried to do it before, but it was a shorter experience, and it was done very poorly. So, yeah, it will... It will definitely make its money back and then some. So good for them. Honestly, I'd like to see a Hardcore Henry game. I would love to play a Hardcore Henry game.
Well, we talked about it last week. Hardcore Henry beat Serious Sam.
Yeah. Serious Ham.
Wait, I thought I was the Serious Ham.
Touche. Movies that beat it: My Big Fat Greek Wedding 2, Zootopia, Batman vs. Superman, Dawn of Justice, and The Boss. So Hardcore Henry, number 5 this weekend. That's really all I have to say about the movie, though. Rage, do you have any further thoughts, questions?
Not really. I'm not a huge movie guy, personally.
Right.
I can enjoy them, but at the same time, I watch only a few movies a year.
Right.
Well, I should say new movies.
I think that you would enjoy this one.
And I should even clarify that and say new to me.
Right. I think you would enjoy this one. It's definitely right up any gamer's alley who enjoys FPS, or really any games that are more than just like puzzle games and stuff like that. Like, if you like RPGs, shooters, narratively focused games, like anything like that. This has things that appeal to you due to the wide
net. Well, what if I enjoy games that have people shooting other people in the face?
You will definitely enjoy it then.
Okay.
If you like those games, you'll like Hardcore Henry.
Well, what if I like games where I collect bear asses and climb radio towers for bear asses?
There's no collection of bear asses, but there is some collection. Oh, there is some collection in the game. He has to collect some things. There's a fetch quest. I'm serious. There's a fetch quest. And there's a...
Did he climb a radio tower?
You climbed a building and you ran across a bridge. The top of a bridge, so...
Yeah. Oh, I just thought... But if they had a third external shot, they should have had him climb a radio tower and just this long sweeping panoramic view of the city. Yo, very Far Cry.
That would have been pretty cool, actually.
See, they should have hired me as an idea person.
I mean, there are tons of video game stuff inspiration in this movie. It's very clear that it's there. I picked out a number of distinct video game things from the movie. At least a dozen, probably more if I sat down and really thought about it. But like really big, obvious, overt things. There's at least a dozen.
I mean, he's following a quest marker the entire time.
He is, yeah. He receives several quests with quest markers that he has to follow. So
I think that wraps up Hardcore Henry.
That does.
Should we move on to a topic that I could actually talk about now?
Yeah, now it's my turn to go to sleep. Okay, so the BAFTAs.
Yeah, so this is going to be one that we're going to both contribute to.
Right. So the BAFTAs is a big awards, gaming awards thing that happens every
year. Yeah, the British version of basically the Academy Awards. This is their subdivision of that for gaming.
How do you want
to... And they have some interesting choices and topics here. Or categories, I guess I should say.
How do you want to do this? How do you want to go through it?
Well, I'm going to do the audience award first, and then we'll just go down the list on the other page.
Okay.
Their first one that we're going to talk about is the AMD Esports Audience Award, which this caused me to think a little bit. Isn't it weird that how intertwined gaming hardware and actually publishers as well is with award shows? And you don't really see that with any other media.
Yeah. That's something that's always bothered me, and that's definitely a topic for another time, but...
Yeah, maybe that's something that we should put on the general discussion list.
It's frustrating, I will just say, like, very quickly. It's frustrating to see that these companies butt their heads into the awards like that. Because, I mean, you don't get the 20th Century Fox Academy Awards...
Yeah, don't get me wrong. The Oscars do have sponsors.
Oh, yeah, they do.
But it's not like Paramount is sponsoring the Oscars.
Right. Anyways.
It just feels like a general conflict of interest. And it's something that popped up whenever I saw the name of this award. The AMD Esports Audience Award. It went to Smite.
Which I find interesting because the games that were nominated were Call of Duty Black Ops 3, Counter-Strike GO, Dota 2, Hearthstone, League of Legends, and Smite.
Yeah, Smite is probably the one that I would say is least worthy of an esports award.
Nah, Call of Duty.
Yeah, true, but it's also very big on consoles for tournaments.
That's fair.
Yeah, they like their shooters with auto-aim. I don't understand why, but they like it in their tournament situations. Well, I'm being completely honest there.
I know you are, but that's just...
In a tournament situation... A game with auto aim or aim assist is very popular. I don't understand that.
Well, I mean, it's console.
And I'm sure I'm going to get a few emails talking about that one.
Yeah, nobody ever seems to send us emails when we're like, well, I guess somebody's going to say that we're a bunch of shitheads on that.
Yeah, it's been an agree-a-thon.
So, yeah, that's yet to happen. We've had some disagreeable emails, but it's never on the things that we're like, yep, somebody's going to call us out on that one.
Yeah, but it's also been a good discussion as well, so.
True. But anyways, yeah, I'm surprised that Smite won. I figured that either Dota or League of Legends would have won that.
Or maybe Hearthstone with how Blizzard's been pushing the esports scene with it.
Maybe, but Hearthstone honestly is a really crappy esports
game. Yeah, that's the distant third. Counter-Strike GO is kind of the dark horse for me. I don't know enough about it. But I do know that it also has some good esports stuff going on with it.
Yeah, but Counter-Strike is... just not as big as League of Legends or Dota is. I mean, it's big for sure in the esports world, and it's a good esports game, but it's not as big as LoL and Dota. So, I mean, Smite was probably, okay, I would have figured League of Legends, then Dota, then Counter-Strike, then Smite. So Smite would have been number four on my guess of what game would have won.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm glad
But
that it
also remember,
won.
this is the audience award, so it's essentially a popularity contest.
That's true. And League of Legends and Dota are both not super popular in the public eye just because of how toxic the communities are.
Yeah.
And Smite isn't too much better, but it is better.
Yeah, and just based on some of the topics, or I keep saying topics, of some of the categories, I kind of want to say that the people in control of this don't really know gaming all that well, but we'll get to that later.
Right. Okay. So are you ready to start working down the list?
Yeah, we're gonna this is gonna take a while. Let's start on the first row and the very first one.
Okay. The first award was Artistic Achievement, and it went to Ori and the Blind Forest. I really can't argue too much with that one. We talked about this with the last awards show that we brought up. Ori won a couple of art design awards. I mean, it really is a beautiful game with a great, not quite unique compared to the other games that were nominated, but a great, fanciful art style. So, I mean, out of the other games that were listed, I can't really fault them for picking Ori.
Yeah, the other games listed was Assassin's Creed Syndicate, Batman: Arkham Knight, which I hope it has good art because of the it's going to be a slideshow for a lot of PC players.
Oh, sick burn. Low-hanging
Well,
fruit.
just wait till later. Everyone's Gone to Rapture, Metal Gear Solid 5, The Phantom Pain, and Witcher 3: The Wild Hunt.
Right. I don't really have much to
I
say
think
on.
that's actually the only award Witcher 3 was up for. No, it was up for a few, but it didn't win anything. Spoiler there.
So yeah, I mean, unless you have anything to add or any dissenting
Not really.
opinion.
We did cover a lot of these, but some of the later ones we're going to have some more discussion about, I think.
Right. Okay, so next, audio achievement, and that was Everybody's Gone to the Rapture. First of all, what the heck is audio achievement?
Yeah, there's just. It sounds like they're trying to apply what they know from films to gaming when it's not a one-to-one transformation there.
Yeah. I don't have too much of an argument with Everybody's Gone to the Rapture. That's the one thing that Everybody's Gone to the Rapture did. And I'm going to read audio achievement as sound design. I don't know if that's
Yeah.
correct or not, but that's how I interpret that category.
Yeah,
The
same
only other
here.
game that I would make an argument for is Star Wars Battlefront.
Yeah, I was about to say, Star Wars Battlefront, it basically is a Star Wars movie.
Yeah, I mean, Battlefront, the one thing that, well, the two things that Battlefront gets right is that it looks like Star Wars and it sounds like Star Wars.
And it plays like the
Again, low-hanging fruit, but understandable.
prequels.
So, you know, this category,
Well, I shouldn't say that because the pod racing game was pretty
the
good.
pod racing game was really good. I love pod racing. I actually had a conversation with a client today about that, actually.
Well, I just thought of that. It's like, oh, wait.
But yeah, if they're trying to be a little more artsy, I could see why they'd pick Everybody's Gone to the Rapture over Star Wars. Because, like, you know, that's one of the only things that it got well, was it had great sound design and sound effects and voice acting and stuff like that. Next.
Well, we should give all the nominees.
Sure.
Assassin's Creed Syndicate, once again. Batman: Arkham Knight, again. Metal Gear Solid 5: The Phantom Pain, again. And The Witcher 3: Wild Hunt, again. Along with Star Wars Battlefront.
Yep. So,
I'm going to be rating those a lot, aren't I?
yeah. That's,
Okay,
unless you want to
now we
trade
go
out,
to
that's your
the...
job.
Yeah. Yeah, now we go to the real meat of this one, the game of the year.
Yep.
And this feels like the safe choice. You know, they took the game that everyone was talking about. It's like, okay, that's game of the year,
Yep.
but
Best
not
game
really
or game of the
what
year.
the game with the best one that is out there.
Yeah. They gave their best game award to Fallout 4. Fallout 4 was a great game, and it was a bit controversial. There were a lot of people who disliked the way that it took the Fallout series. I liked the way they took the Fallout series, but, you know, that's one of those things that it comes down to personal preference. I'm not going to fault anybody for disliking it, but I agree with you. I think Fallout 4 was the safe choice.
Yeah, especially considering some of their other options here. They don't have a lot here that I would really call Game of the Year titles. They have good games here, all of them.
Yeah, their games. I'll read the list this time. The other nominees were Everybody's Gone to the Rapture, Life is Strange, Metal Gear Solid 5, The Phantom Pain, Rocket League, and The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt.
Yeah, and really, I think the only other one here that is a contender for it is The Witcher 3.
Metal Gear Solid also, I think, is a contender. It had a lot of problems that Konami added to the game, mm-hmm. but, I mean, it's Kojima's last labor of love, and it was a solid game outside of the very clear Konami fucking around. I could see how Konami dragging it down would be enough to keep it from Game of the Year, and I accept that, but I do think that Metal Gear Solid was a better game than Fallout 4.
Counterpoint, they don't seem to give a fuck about problems with the game.
True.
Just because of the next category. Shall I read this one?
Sure, you read this one.
The best British game went to Batman Arkham Knight, because obviously they never heard of the fucking PC problems that they had with the port.
Yeah.
This is the first game that came out after the Steam refund system. And it was pulled from Steam for, what was it, months?
Yeah, it was a long time.
And that is the best the British fucking house has to offer? What is the other games on this list? Absolute shit? Do you open up the box and just a turd flops out onto your lap?
No, actually. Because
that's the only way I can imagine it.
Most of the rest of the games are actually quite good. The rest of the list, Everybody's Gone to the Rapture, which, let's be honest, that game was shit. I'm just going to get that out of the way. That's a turd. Had good sound, otherwise the game's a turd. Past that, it's good stuff. Her Story, amazing. Prison Architect, really good. Tearaway Unfolded, I'm not familiar with. But Until Dawn was great. It received numerous awards and nominations for just its well-put-together storyline and characters and what it did.
Yeah, I think someone somewhere got both a blowjob and a suitcase full of money for Batman to win this category. I don't know who, but that's what happened. That's my money. That's how I think they won this.
I don't think so. Maybe, but I don't think so. I think that they looked at the list and went, what's the only AAA game on there? Batman? Okay, that's the winner. Because Prison Architect? Indie. Her Story? Indie. Everybody's Gone to the Rapture? Indie. I'm not sure about Tearaway. And Until Dawn is kind of one of the last remaining games in that middle category between indie and AAA. But it's still not AAA. And then I'm not sure about Tearaway. Like I said, I'm not familiar with that game. But I think this one was just like, what's the AAA game on the list? That one.
Yeah. And also, I didn't know Batman was British. Is it true? Alfred was telling the truth the entire time. He really is Batman?
Oh.
Okay, that's my micro rant out of the way, because I saw this and I actually tweeted out that exact thought. Have they never heard of the PC problems?
Yeah.
Because if Batman can win this category, then Metal Gear Solid 5 should have had a good chance at Game of the Year. Best Game.
So this next one is another category I don't understand. Debut Game.
I'm assuming this means company that this is their first game.
That actually makes sense, because all of these are first-time games on this list. The winner was Her Story, which is a great, phenomenal game. We talked about it at length on a previous podcast when it won a couple of awards. I won't delve too much into it again, but basically, Her Story is just an experiment in storytelling and narrative-driven games, and it does its job amazingly. Great characters, a great mystery, really interesting game mechanic for how you discover the story. So.
And the other nominees are Keep Talking and Nobody Explodes, Lovers in a Dangerous Space Time, Mini Metro, Ori and the Blind Forest, and Prune.
Not familiar with Prune, but otherwise I recognize every game on that list, and they are all...
I recognize, about the same. I would say the other really good contender would have been Keep Talking and Nobody Explodes.
Yeah, I think that was another good contender.
Especially for the innovation category, which is coming up.
Lovers in a Dangerous Space Time, actually, I think would have had a good shot at that. It's just a really in-depth, complicated co-op game that is about two people basically trying to save their spaceship. There's four or six stations on the ship that you have to man, and there's only two of you, and you have to work together to save the ship for as long as you can. It's a really fun game. The only problem with it is that it's local co-op only. That sucks, but otherwise, good game. Anyways, next on the list, family game. And the best family game was Rocket League. Kind of a weird list outside of Rocket League, though.
Yeah, it's pretty much anything that you would be able to play with a kid.
Yeah, that's a good way to look at it. Kid-friendly games. The other
Disney Infinity 3.0, Play Without Limits. Or is that Pay Without Limits? I can't quite read that font. Sorry.
But
FIFA 16, Guitar Hero Live, Lego Dimensions, and Super Mario Maker.
Yeah. Kid-friendly games. Out of the list, I have to say that I think Rocket League is the best, but...
Yeah, they keep adding a lot to Rocket League. When it first came out, it was pretty much just a standard... Well, I shouldn't say standard, but it was literally just soccer only with rocket cars. But they've added a lot with the mutators, the hockey mode, and they actually have a basketball mode coming in, I think, this month.
Wow, that sounds really interesting. I really need to play Rocket League.
You sound really sarcastic when you say
that. No, that's a serious wow. Like, that's like, wow. Like, how do they do that? Hockey mode makes sense. Hockey is basically soccer on ice.
The thing is that Rocket League has a lot of aerial movement to it.
Yeah, that's true. I've played...
So it's pretty much just, once again, soccer, only they change the bounciness of the ball a bit, and they make it so that the goal, instead of the goal being a traditional soccer goal, they just move the goal up and have it as a ring.
Yeah, I should buy it and play it more. I've played it some on a friend's PS4, but I should buy it on PC and play it more.
Yeah, it's a pretty good game. My biggest complaint about Rocket League is that while it has cross-platform connectivity, you can't make groups with people on different platforms. So if you were playing on PS4 and I had it on PC, we can't play together unless we just happen to be teamed up on the thousands and thousands of people in the matchmaking.
That kind of sucks, but...
That's my biggest complaint about it.
Yeah, but it does at least have cross-platform play. Because of the type of game it is, people with mouse and keyboard don't have a super big advantage over people who play using a gamepad.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, I would say it's best to play with a gamepad.
Yeah, a lot of times driving games usually are, and even though there's a lot of aerial movement and craziness, it is, at its core, a driving game. Or maybe a soccer game. I don't know. That's a tough call. Next category, though, is game design. And I'm guessing that means, like, overall game design in terms of, like, a theme coming together, art, sound, that sort of thing. Because the winner in the category was Bloodborne. Other nominees were Grow Home, Her Story, Lovers in Dangerous Space Time, Rocket League, and The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt. And based on
The Witcher 3, always the bridesmaid, never the bride.
Yeah, but the bridesmaid can be hot too. Yeah,
easier to bang.
Not always.
Considering some of the letters and tweets, that's going to generate some news.
Oh yeah. But Bloodborne, I totally get. Bloodborne had an amazingly put together, well mixed. And what's the right word I'm looking for? I guess it stuck to its theme really well. everything is very atmospheric and it matches everything else in the atmosphere. Everything works well together. It had great sound design, great art design. So I totally get that in the sense that this is like an overall category because that's how I'm reading it. The Witcher
Yeah.
3 was also, I think, a big contender for that, but there are a whole lot of different areas in The Witcher 3, and not that Bloodborne doesn't have different areas.
Well, the thing is that if it's they're using just overall design, I'm not sure about that because I played Girl Home. I actually have a series on that on my channel.
Ding.
Well, wasn't going that far, but okay, Gaming with Caffeine Rage.
Ding ding.
And it's pretty much a standard low voxel game. There wasn't a lot art style wise that really stood out to me. So I'm not sure if it's just me being absolutely dense, which is very possible, or if they were hard up for game design.
You mean
Because
Grow Home or Bloodborne?
Grow Home.
Oh, okay. I don't know.
Because it's kind of weird to see it on this list.
I thought Grow Home had a cutesy theme that even though it seemed to be a bit disjointed, the art style that they chose and made it w mesh well together.
To me, it was just pretty much your standard low voxel art style.
I don't know. Maybe I'm reading too much into it, but I felt like that it was a bit of an art house type game.
It was just, it's weird to see it on this list, I should say. I could understand the other ones,
I'm not
but.
100% sure about Rocket League. Not that it's not like a game that's put together well, but it's just like Rocket League is really crazy and really out there. So I don't, maybe they're just meaning like a game that stands out for some reason or another.
Yeah, if they have it where it's standing out, then I could see that a bit easier just because trying to think of a way to put it. It had this weird procedurally generated animation that was just strange on the robot itself.
Well, that could have put it in the next category then. See that segue? Game innovation. Her Story took this category, which makes sense. But every game I think that they picked had a bit of innovation into it. The other nominees were Everybody's Gone to the Rapture. Maybe not that one so much. Life is Strange.
Which I'm not 100% sure on that one. Granted, I haven't looked too much into it, but it looks like pretty much minor spoilers, possibly, but a time travel story told in an episodic method.
That's the gist of Life is Strange, but in a world where that characters are portrayed very unrealistically, Life is Strange's characters are actually very believable, very realistic, both the men and the
Okay, so
females. They're
that's where the innovation is. Actually good writing.
yeah, it's actually a really good, well-written, believable story, aside from the time travel bit.
Okay.
Metal Gear Solid 5, Phantom Pain. Not sure what's innovative about that, to be honest.
Konami fucking over Kojima one last time.
I guess. I don't know. Splatoon,
See that one.
very innovative in terms of what a shooter is. And then Until Dawn, which, with its actually very non-linear story, unique. Because even though lots of games promise you choice, most of the time it's the illusion of choice. But there are tons of branching paths in Until Dawn with multiple endings. That I think is where the innovation comes in on that one. I think that Her Story is definitely the strongest out of the list that they have given. I think Splatoon has got a real shot at perhaps you arguing me down off of Her Story. But otherwise, nothing else on the list comes close in my mind.
Yeah, her story is basically the darling of the BAFTAs, let's be honest.
And is it won what, three awards, four awards?
Looking, I'm seeing three.
Yeah, it won three. It
It
won
was
the
nominated for quite a few more.
yeah. It won the next award, which is mobile and handheld.
Yeah, I wish they didn't combine mobile and handheld because it feels a little bit unfair.
Yeah, mobile and handheld games are still very different. Technically, they're both portable games, so if they wanted to combine them into like a portable games category, but handhelds being in the modern market, the 3DS and the PS Vita are a completely different machine to mobile, which is iPad or tablet and smartphone games. There's a tiny bit of crossover from time to time, but for the most part, they're two different beasts. And honestly, the only games that we see on here, I think, are all mobile titles.
Yeah, I'm not seeing anything that jumps out to me as a... let's be honest. The only contender for handheld nowadays is the DS, right? Nintendo.
Yeah.
Because Sony's pretty much packed up and gone home.
Yeah, the Vita basically exists as a way for you to play your PS4 games mobily and then to play JRPGs.
Yeah, maybe they should rename this the mobile category and then give Nintendo their own category.
The best 3DS game. I'm not familiar with several games in this list, yeah. Actually. The Room 3, Prune, and Alpha Bear are all games that I'm not super familiar with.
Yeah, the other ones are Lara Croft Go. Wait, the rest of this is cut off. Go where?
Touche.
Sorry.
Lara Croft Go, Fallout Shelter. Yeah, those are the only two that I didn't name already, outside of her story.
Yeah.
Fallout Shelter was fun, but it's not really a game. It's difficult to say because it's more of like a weird take on like Cookie Clicker.
Yeah, I was going to ask Cookie Clicker-ish.
Yeah, it's more Farmville. More Farmville, more
which is disappointing less. Because I'd really like a management game that is in the Fallout universe.
Yeah, it's cutesy, but there's not really much management to it. I mean, I played it for a little while, but I got to like 100 and something settlers, and then I just was like, why am I still playing this? There's no challenge left. It's just I log in, I check on who I need to rotate into the baby making room, and then
check on the breeders.
Seriously, I did have a group of women with like the highest stats, and they were breeders. And I would rotate in.
Oh my! Well, but you know that's problematic.
Yeah, in real life it would be, because you limit the gene pool. But this isn't real life. I was maximizing my stats. Next category is a multiplayer game. Rocket League won that. It went up against Destiny, The Taken King, which I don't think that should be on there. The Taken King is DLC.
Yeah, that's a weird distinction. Where do you cross the line on when a game should be eligible? Should it just be the base game, or should World of Warcraft's 20th expansion be eligible for a game of the year?
I don't think so. Not unless the expansion does so much to change the game that it's not even the same game anymore. And The Taken King did not do that. The Taken King made The Taken King made Destiny the game it should have been when it launched, but it didn't really make it a new game. It just added all the things that should have been there from the beginning. So you might could argue me on that one to where I would change my mind, but right now I don't think that that's enough to qualify it to be on the list. But regardless, Destiny the Taken King, Lovers in a Dangerous Space-Time, which I don't think should be on there since it's local co-op only.
Yeah.
While I think local co-op or local multiplayer is still important...
it shouldn't be the only option.
I agree. Splatoon, which I think has a good shot, or had a good shot. Rainbow Six Siege, nah. And World of Warships, which is surprising. Technically, that did launch. Technically...
But it had a long alpha period as well, so where we also get messy. Where do you have that distinction?
World of Warships, I don't know. I don't want to... It's my favorite out of all the games on the list, but I don't know if it's the best.
Do you want to get me my World of Warships rant again? I had so many issues with World of Warships, just not wanting to work correctly. Having weird FPS drops for no apparent reason, and it wasn't my old hardware. It was... just the game itself fucking up. I had crashing issues. And then the grind. I don't care that much for a game that is that grindy. Or that apparently grindy, I should say.
Yeah, it's very grindy. Even if you spend money on premium time and currency, it's still very grindy. Yeah, it's my favorite, but I don't think it's the best. Honestly, I think the best is Splatoon.
Well, I haven't played Splatoon. The only one out of this I've played is Rocket League. From everything I've seen, Rainbow Six Siege is actually pretty good. It's a interesting take on attack defend.
Rainbow Six Siege is a
If it's
good.
the one I'm thinking of, at least.
Yeah, Rainbow Six Siege is a good, is a well-rated multiplayer game. But the thing that drives me nuts about Rainbow Six Siege is it fall. It's
It's
a pre
team.
it.
Oh, sorry. I was going to say it's a team-based game, and for random people, that is a definite downfall.
Well, that, but also it's a AAA game with microtransactions in it, and I
So
think that
yeah,
that should
I can.
automatically disqualify you.
So yeah, I didn't know it had microtransactions in it.
Yep, it does. It's got a premium currency and everything.
Ugh, fucking hate that. Well, I take back everything I said nice about Rainbow Six Siege.
Yep.
Microtransactions and a AAA full price release should not exist.
Next on the list, the music category. And the winner was Everybody's Gone to the Rapture. And it went up against Assassin's Creed Syndicate, Batman Arkham Knight, Fallout 4, Halo 5 Guardians, and Ori and the Blind Forest.
I'm going to go out on the limb and say Fallout 4 probably shouldn't be on this list because it doesn't have as much unique music or original music. If it's anything like the previous Fallouts, at least a lot of Fallout, the Fallout 3 and Fallout New Vegas relied on licensed music.
Well, I don't think that that's necessarily a bad thing. A soundtrack doesn't necessarily have to be all original, I think.
I would have loved to
Take, for
seen
example.
I would have loved to seen a second category, original score, and not throw everything together into the music category.
Right.
I think that's a better way of saying what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, I would be okay with that. I think that's acceptable. But I mean, just like some things that don't have original music but have amazing soundtracks, like Guardians of the Galaxy, that movie was made by the soundtrack. If you removed the soundtrack and replaced it with another one, the movie wouldn't be as good. It just the soundtrack for that was amazing. Hardcore Henry had the same thing. It had a great soundtrack. If you removed it and replaced it with different music, would have lessened the experience.
Yeah,
So
but I'm talking about winning an award when there's just one general music category.
Yeah.
I
I
would
would
have much
prefer
rather
to
seen soundtrack and then original score. But considering an upcoming category, I'm not convinced these guys know what they're doing. Especially with the well, and based on what we've already talked about, the Batman thing. Yes, I'm not going to let that go.
And I don't think you should have to. Yeah, out of this list, I mean, like I said, everybody's gone to the Rapture. Its sound design and its music were the only things about the game that were good at all. Fallout 4 has got mostly the same soundtrack from Fallout 3, which is really sad. Halo 5 Guardians soundtrack is okay, but it's just Halo at this point. If you've heard the Halo soundtrack before, you know what to expect in Halo 5 Guardians. And while it's not bad, it's old hat at this point. Batman Arkham Knight, okay music. And Ori and the Blind Forest had pretty good music, but I see why they gave it to Everybody's Gone to the Rapture. Next on the list, Performer.
Yeah, I'm
They
gonna
gave
make
it.
your no, it's a original property.
Oh, did I skip one? I apologize, I did skip one. Original property, Until Dawn.
Yeah, I think this is a original IP, but they're naming it weirdly.
Yeah, new IP, or perhaps they're going for like.
Well, there's nothing here that screams a sequel to me. Unless you
Yeah.
count like Life is Strange, which is a nominee, being broken into five parts, but I don't count that.
Yeah.
So I'm going to go with this is a new IP.
Yeah. They gave it to Until Dawn. It went up against Everybody's Gone to the Rapture, Her Story, Life is Strange, Ori and the Blind Forest, and Splatoon. That's tough. There's several very good games on this list, good new IPs. So, it's tough. Until Dawn, I think, is a good choice. I also would have been happy about Splatoon, Life is Strange, or Her Story. Ori was not bad, but I don't think that it has got the brand power to make a sequel. And Everybody's Gone to the Rapture was just shit outside of the music. And the sound.
You love shitting on that game as almost as much as I love shitting on Batman, and we both like hitting on Evolve.
Yep. You know, now that I've said that, her story actually might not have been a good choice for this category, just because even though it was an interesting game, I don't know if you could make a second one. At least not in her story. Maybe like that style.
Here's the problem is that they made this category so ambiguous. What they mean by it? Are they meaning that this is a building block for other properties, or just a brand new property without the promise of a sequel?
Tough to know. Tough to know. You're right. Too ambiguous. Next is Performer, the one that I tried to skip to.
Yeah, and I'm gonna make you read all these because I would just butcher some of these names.
That's fine. The first, or the winner of the category, was Merle Dandridge from Everybody's Gone to the Rapture. I don't know who that character was in there. I'm assuming the narrator,
It would be nice if they gave character names. But that would be too useful.
yeah. Next, Ashley Burch from Life is Strange. I'm assuming that the girl that they're showing is the character that she was the voice actor for, or actress, but I could be wrong.
Yeah.
Doug Koechel for The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt. Oliver Dimmesdale, Everybody's Gone to the
Yeah,
Rapture.
well, see, here's the problem is that they're showing the same character for Everyone's Gone to the Rapture twice.
That's true. Mark Hamill for Batman Arkham Knight.
I didn't know he voiced Batman.
Yeah, my theory about the character is definitely wrong because Mark Hamill does the Joker.
Wait, he
And
does?
then, yeah.
Spoiler!
He's done the Joker for years.
Wait, he has?
Yeah. Are you being serious or are you being
I'm
sarcastic?
being sarcastic.
Oh, okay. And then Masaasa Moyo for Broken Age Act 2. I don't know many, well, except for Mark Hamill, I don't know any of these voice actors. So I really don't know what to say. It's hard for me to go, yeah, Mark Hamill should have won just because he's the only name that I recognize. I
Yeah,
do
well,
know
Mark
that.
Hamill does an amazing, breadth of voice work. So he is definitely the strong person in this. But at the same time, they may have said, "Well, he's a well-known guy, and we've already given that turd of a game one award. Can we give it a second?"
Yeah. Like I said though, everybody's gone to the rapture. Good sound design, so that extends the voice acting.
So, shall we move on to the most perplexing category?
Yeah, sure.
So, persistent game. What the
What the
fuck does this
fuck is a
mean?
persistent game?
Because the titles in this are just all over the fucking place.
Yeah.
This is
Okay.
more mixed up than the family title,
Right. So the winner was Prison Architect,
which is
and I
an
can
amazing
totally.
game, but I'm not sure if I would call it persistent because.
Well, I could see the argument though, because it's, you develop this thing over a long period of time and you put a lot of work and effort into it, into a single project to grow it
But then
out.
you burn to the ground. It doesn't. To me, a persistent game would always be there. It's basically almost MMO-esque.
Right.
Yeah,
I could.
maybe if your prison gets shifted off into the background and is still almost Dwarf Fortress-like, where you'll get prisoners that are transferred in from that, but the mistakes you made in that prison carry over until you delete the entire world. That's what I would think whenever they say persistent game.
Next on the list was Destiny the Taken King, which I actually could see this because Destiny is just an MMO. It's an FPS MMO. And so that makes sense that Destiny would be on this list for
Yeah.
persistent game. It's not a good game, but it makes sense that it's on the list. Next is Final Fantasy Online, or Final Fantasy 14 Online. MMO, okay, makes sense, sure.
Yeah, I try to figure out this next one though.
Guitar Hero Live. What? Like, what? That it makes no sense in comparison with the rest of the games.
It makes
It's
sense compared to Prison Architect, maybe, I guess.
the only thing in Guitar Hero Live that I can think would make them qualify that for this category is the Guitar Hero Radio, which is basically this an online mode that you go to that has all of the songs that are available in the game, basically on random or put into specific playlists to go along with themes, and it's just constantly cycling through songs. That's the only thing I can think of that would make it persistent in any way whatsoever.
Yeah, that's just so weird.
All right.
Then Lego Next, Dimensions.
Lego Dimensions, which is that the building Lego game, or is that the... There's a lot of Lego games. Let's just go
I think this is the MMO one.
Oh, yeah. It's the one that mashes all of the other Lego game characters together.
Yeah, it's basically Skylanders.
Right? Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's the Skylanders, Amiibo type of thing.
Oh, let's put it this way. The screenshot that they're using for it is Marty McFly playing... let's just assume it's Johnny B. Goode in front of Batman.
And Batman's got like this kind of weird look on his face, like, what's going on? and then the last game is The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt.
What?
I kind of... It's an RPG, yeah, so okay.
It makes as much sense as Prison Architect, let's be perfectly honest.
Yeah.
It makes as much sense as Prison Architect and Guitar Hero. I mean, sure, fine. Why the fuck not? Witcher 3 needs another nomination and they're not going to win. Here, let's put them in here.
Out of all the games on the list, Destiny and Final Fantasy 14 are the only two that make any sense to me. You could argue to me Prison Architect and The Witcher 3, but Lego Dimensions and Guitar Hero Live, no. Just no.
Okay, so shall we move on to the soccer category?
Yeah, let's move on to the soccer category.
Well, technically it's a sports category, but the winner is Rocket League. And everything except two of these games are soccer games.
Yep. There's Rocket League, which won, Dirt Rally, FIFA 16, Football Manager, Forza Motorsport 6, and PES 2016.
Pro Evolution Soccer, I believe that is.
Yeah, I think you're correct. So, yeah.
Yeah, I hate it when they use acronyms or initialisms for games like this.
So they've got soccer, car soccer,
car racing, game. Racing.
Yeah, racing. You know, there's a lot of other sports games out there. I get that football is like the top sport in the world, but soccer games are boring. Most sports games are really boring. I've played FIFA 15. I've not played FIFA 16, but I can imagine that it's basically the same game. And Pro Evolution Soccer is the same thing.
I have you know that they update the roster.
They do that. And I think FIFA 16 added women's soccer, which is great and all, but it's the same thing just with women. You know, I just don't get it. There's a lot of other sports games out there. I mean, heck, we play Winning Putt Golf, and that's a better game than FIFA is. I'm serious. It's got a better art style. It's a lot more in-depth, and there's a lot more variety to it. Better game. Should have won. I get Rocket League being up there, but I would much rather see an actual good sports game win. And it doesn't necessarily have to be Winning Putt, but there's a lot of sports.
Well, technically, Winning Putt hasn't released yet. It's in the alpha stages or the beta stages. So there's always next year. But out of all of these, I would say Rocket League is the most innovative because they're doing something different outside of its prequel, which I'm blanking on the name of. It's just this absurdly long title, but it's the same. It's different. It's the one that's not a real sport on this.
Right.
Have you noticed that? It's the only one that's not a real sport.
Yeah, that's true. Because car racing
unless you count some maybe odd modes in Forza, if there is one.
No, Forza's all racing. There's no kind of weird comedy
I'm talking about more gamey or maybe mini-gamey stuff that may have been in there that I didn't know about.
No. Well, yeah, I guess there's the weird, like, Top Gear challenge tracks that were in Forza 5. I'm not sure what's going to be in Forza 6, but you had, like, a weird little bowling mode where you had to knock down bowling pins as you drifted around a track.
So this is literally the only non-real sports game, and it wins the sports category.
Football Manager, maybe not. I've never played it, so I don't know if there's actually any. I
It's
mean, it,
literally you're from everything I understand, you're managing a soccer team.
yeah, so it's a management game that just happens to be about sports. I'm not sure I'd call that a sports game, but you know,
Yeah,
whatever.
but Football Manager, they actually leave it off here. If it's the one I'm thinking about, it's updated literally every year, so it's iteration, iteration, iteration.
Which brings us to our last category, which is story. Life is Strange won best story this year, and it went up against Everybody's Gone to the Rapture, which doesn't really
Oh boy.
have a
Here we go
story.
again.
Her Story, which is an interesting method in storytelling, but honestly, the story for Her Story is not that great. The discovery is much better than the actual story. Undertale, which I don't know why that didn't win. Until Dawn and The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt. Life is Strange was a good story. It is fairly cliched, but the main thing that makes the story of Life is Strange so good is the fact that the characters actually feel like real people. Which
Well,
is.
maybe that's maybe they shouldn't have this be story and just have best writing.
Yeah, I could totally see best writing for Life is Strange. Best story, though, I feel like it has to go to Undertale.
Yeah, I haven't played Undertale yet, and that's one I don't want spoilers for.
Okay, I won't do anything to spoil it. If you're interested in learning about Undertale, listeners, just go look it up, watch a couple of Let's Plays, or read a couple of walkthroughs. The story for Undertale is extremely diverse. It takes some very winding and interesting paths, and the way that it involves the player is, well, it's something that has been copied a lot now because of the meta nature of the story, but it's great. I cannot understand why they didn't pick it just based on like story.
They didn't get paid enough.
Yeah, I guess not.
They needed a blowjob and a suitcase of money.
Every game on this list, except for Everybody's Gone to the Rapture, has got a good story for one reason or another one. Just Undertale, I feel like, is the best story. Life is Strange is not a bad one, just Undertale is better.
Yeah, maybe they did mean best writing.
Yeah, if it was best writing, I totally understand why it went to Life is Strange. Because those characters are extremely believable, they interact in very normal and natural ways. And then there's some clever stuff that's thrown in with the time travel. The Witcher had some good writing as well, though. The fact that it tells you a story during what normally is just wasted time for games is interesting, like walking to a quest the way that
Yeah,
they
but
do.
obviously they don't care about gameplay, otherwise Batman wouldn't have won. Yes, bring it all the way back around.
All the way back around to Batman being shit, but somehow winning an award. Yeah, that's the end of the
Well,
BAFTAs, I think.
unless there's a video game equivalent of the Razzies. I wonder if that's I wonder if that's out there, now that I think about it.
I don't know. Maybe.
Or maybe that's something that we should do.
We should do our own game awards this coming year. At around Christmas time, we should do game awards for best
We
stuff.
kind of did our best games of the year on what was it, the second episode, like but we picked the games that we played, not the games that came out.
Yeah. We should do that again this year, except with more thought put into it.
Well, we actually going to have to put forth an effort.
Yeah, we'll have to try for an episode.
Well, obviously we're not game developers. Or at least certain game developers, I should say.
Sick burn, Ubisoft. Sick burn.
Well, actually, I wasn't aiming that at Ubisoft, but okay, we'll go with that.
I turned it right in their faces.
So let's
So,
quickly go through the community corner because we have one letter, and then I pulled out a bunch of tweets because we are recording a day early, and a lot of our mail does come in on Tuesday.
yep. So the letter this week comes to us from Kimmis. He did not send an audio letter this time, and he apologizes for doing so, but he's busy, in short.
And making us do the legwork.
Yep, which is okay. He says, "Greetings, everybody. Kimmis here again. I'm a little late to the Tracer butt party,
Oh my.
so I'll sum my own opinion in a single sentence. I believe in the artist's right to change their mind, including self-censorship, and am willing to give Blizzard the benefit of the doubt that they were going to change it either way. However, the timing of it is highly suspicious, and the subsequent handling of the whole ordeal was an absolute PR shitstorm. On to the topic.
Yeah, well, I pretty much agree with them. Artists should be able to choose what they want to do or even change their mind on something. Well, maybe not George Lucas amounts of changing their mind, but the timing is off. Maybe if they handled it a bit better, it would have been not so, as suspect.
Yeah. I think that's the whole thing that really got to me about it, is that it was just like, it didn't feel like they were changing their mind, like they were, you know, having a different idea about it. It felt like they were
being bullied into it.
Yeah. And they did come out at one point and say, you know, hey, we've been considering changing this for a while. But it's just like the timing and the way that it happened was so suspicious. Like, that was like, it felt like that was their cop out for change, like giving in and changing it.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think
new post is even more sexualized.
Definitely.
Which, the whole thing was caused because this guy felt an erection, and, well, his own erection, most likely, and felt guilty about it. Well, oh boy, is he in trouble. Because we got really into the whole problem of him using his child as a weapon to change something that he didn't like.
Oh, and that's never fun. I don't want to get started. I had a client today whose husband is doing that in a divorce, and I just don't really want to get into it.
Oh, boy.
So let's carry on. He says, I really didn't want to get into the whole video games or sexist discussion, but the point Jared, hey, that's me, made forced me to rethink all of my previous opinions.
To be fair, you are drunk, so I won't hold you to any of that.
I really want to know specifically what point made him rethink his previous opinions. I mean, he goes on to explain a little bit what's going on, but like, I don't know. I think it's mainly the fact that I called out that video games don't treat men and women equal in the sense that they both are extremely unrealistic in games. Anyways, he says the actual problem with games and media as a whole is not the representation of female characters, and instead lies in unrealistic expectations established by characters of either gender. They are chosen to meet requirements of ideal body image, and as this show's resident bisexual, I take on the authority to say they tend to look pretty indecent. What I find interesting is that the way they are perceived says a lot about the gender roles in society, even more so than what they present on their own.
I wonder how much of that is, or the way characters look, is driven by how game design has changed. Because you can't really have just a scrawny guy doing Nathan Drake style stuff.
Yeah, that's true.
Because the art design isn't in a vacuum. It has to be driven at least somewhat by game design as well. I mean, granted, you know, huge tits and a skimpy outfit, you know, that's a bit different. But it also, well, not the huge tits part, but a smaller outfit or, you know, a midriff allows for more flexibility for a female character. I wonder how much of that has influenced art in gaming, you know, in previous years. It's something I just kind of thought about.
I don't know.
Because I don't know. Art design is not in a vacuum with this.
But
and also it's how a lot of these stories are written, because we got into how video games are art. But a lot of story, if you take a look at it on its own, is not exactly high art. It's very basic storytelling still. To the point that you praised Life is Strange for having believable characters.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know.
So maybe, his point coming up, the sex appeal is a cheap way to allow a female character to influence a male character quickly without having to have lots of dialogue.
So it's a way to get past making them believable.
It's a shortcut.
Draw you in. Yeah, it's a shortcut. That's interesting. That makes sense. And I see where that could be used in specific ways to further a story or further a game's agenda. Like, I came across wrong. Like, it's, you know, it's trying to get you to do something or believe something, and it's just a quick way to get you to do that. Quick way to get you to buy into it.
Yeah.
When it's used all the time, it's lazy.
Yeah, it becomes the norm, and then actually believable characters become the oddity.
Yeah.
So maybe we just need better writers.
Yeah, better writing, or people who are willing to take more risks with writing. I mean, books and movies and TV shows have been doing believable female characters for some time now. So, I don't know. I don't know why games can't do it either. And not to say that all books and movies and TV shows get it perfectly. There's lots of those sexy shortcuts in TV shows and movies and books, but they do a better job of it than games do. Also, really quickly, thanks for sharing your sexuality with us, Kimis. That's very brave of you. I recognize that I did it last week, so just wanted to thank you for that, sir. That did not go unnoticed. But boy, we'll move on from that. When confronted with stereotypical female characters soaked wet with sex appeal, the common reaction is to try and fight the stereotype. That's great for whatever reason. When confronted with male protagonists that's 90% muscle and 2% steroid, the reaction is a lot more muted and often backed up with, yep, that's how it should be. It's as if the gender equality only worked one way, focusing on enabling women to take care of themselves and making independent decisions without fearing consequences of society's view on them. All the while, the status of men as the family's tough protector and main breadwinner hasn't changed at all. A woman taking on a male role is a symbol of emaciation, and a man gets ostracized for his effeminate behavior. Yep, I totally agree with you. It's this view that women are the only ones who need to be shown as becoming equal, and that if it happens to men, it's emaciating to them. Because for some reason, despite the fact that women's gender role has evolved in culture over the last couple of centuries, men's has stayed relatively the same. And that's just not true. As women become more and more independent, become more into the workforce, become more breadwinners and less stay-at-home moms, you have men that are starting to leave those traditional roles of being the breadwinner and being, you know, stay-at-home dads or dads that do, or men that do different types of jobs that were traditionally more in women's roles.
Think it, once again, is more just lazy writing?
I think it's lazy writing. It's
and also on... maybe mixing in some gameplay issues as well, because you can't, I can't say that you can't have a stay-at-home dad as the protagonist of a story. You can, definitely can, but it's a lot tougher to do.
Yeah.
Than being, a badass archaeologist or a fighter plane, a pilot or something like that.
Yeah. So it's easier to write a woman into that role as opposed to writing a man into a traditional woman's role. But I mean, it can be done. And I think that we will start to see more and more over the coming years games that focus on other aspects of life, and placing men and women in those aspects of life. The stuff that we consider more mundane and boring, like being a housewife or a house husband, being a parent.
A management game, perhaps trying to balance the budget, but balance all the problems at home, but it's told from a male perspective, from a male character's perspective.
Yeah.
Just throwing that completely out there, just trying to think of a possible way with a different game. Maybe a Papers, Please almost game like that.
Yeah.
Where you're constantly adding more things to deal with.
Right. And it's difficult, I think, for us to think of that because the norm is not that. But I mean, you know, there will be pioneers that pioneer that genre of game, whatever you want to call it. I don't know, the life simulator or...
Well, pretty much the life simulator is The Sims right now, isn't it?
Yeah, I suppose that's true.
Into things like Dwarf Fortress being a life simulator. But that's more of a death simulator.
You know, I think we'll start to see more stories that really focus on the narrative aspects of being a man dealing with issues that come with being a man. Dealing with these gender stereotypes that you have against being a man, dealing with these social stigmas that come from being a man. Like, oh, you're supposed to be the man. Why is your wife the one who's working, and why do you stay at home with the kids? It's like, I don't know. We will see that happening in the next decade or two, probably, maybe even sooner than that. But I mean, when one gender role changes, the other one has to change too. It's not like women can just suddenly take over or become independent, or sorry, it's not like suddenly women can become 100% equal to men and men don't change at all. Like, that's not the way the world works. Perhaps in an ideal world for some people, that should be what happens. And to some extent, I think that people should just be equal in general. I mean, I said that last time. I like to consider myself
a humanist. Yeah, only you're sober this time.
Yeah, I'm sober this time. I like to consider myself a humanist, you know. The ideas of classic feminism, I think, rang true. Like, women wanted equal gender rights to men. And I think that's fine. Men and women should be equal.
But yeah, well, the problem is that the loud voice of feminism now is kill all men.
Yeah. But, you know, in order for men and women to be equal, women have to gain some power and men have to give up some power. That's just the way it works. And I mean, we've been seeing that happen in our culture as the old guard dies off, the baby boomer generation and Generation X, as they start to die off. We'll see Generation Y, or the millennials, as they are colloquially known, start to bring in more of these ideas of gender equality, and we'll start to see the gender lines erased a bit. There will always be some things that are women only and men only, for example, unless medical science really steps up and does some crazy things. But I mean, at least for the near future, men can't have babies. It's physiologically impossible.
Boy, that would be painful.
That would be.
I mean, even more so.
And it's physically and physiologically impossible for women to be as strong as men, like physically. So I doubt we'll see a huge shift in the physical labor market from men to women. It's going to go to robots. But, you know, there are things like that that unless the medical industry steps up and really does some genetic changes to us at the core of what it is to be a human, we won't see those changes. But societally, we are going to see over the next decade or two erasing of the gender lines to some extent. And that will be fun for games and media in general, just to see what happens when it's okay for there to be a stay-at-home dad and there's not some shame associated with that. And it's okay to be a career-driven woman who works until, you know, you're 75 and is a CEO or whatever. I can't wait for the day where it's okay for a woman to feel fine to not want to have kids. Because, you know, kids aren't for everybody, men or women. Yeah. Just because you're a woman, that doesn't mean that it's your job to have as many babies as possible.
Unless you're in Jared's bunker.
If you're in my bunker and fallout shelter, that's your job. But in the real world, it's your body. You do whatever the hell you want with it. As long as it's not hurting other people. If you start hurting other people, then that's a problem. But, I mean, if you want to have kids, have kids. If you don't want to have kids, don't have kids. Don't let anybody tell you any different. Anyways, I will step down from my soapbox again. To finish off Kimis's letter, if you're complaining about the lack of well-written female characters, you have to recognize that most male characters aren't so great either. I'm not the one to see malice in phenomena that can be explained by incompetence. The issues lie way deeper, and I have strong suspicion that those who cry the loudest may be a part of it. Games aren't sexist. They're not that sexy either, because I'd much rather look at somebody with realistic body proportions. And even stereotypical gender role representation is not inherent to the industry, as it's something ubiquitous in all media and outside of them. Fuck, fuck, fuck. Yes.
Drink, drink, drink.
Yeah, I agree. Most male characters aren't written great either. I think that we let male characters, we give them a pass a lot more because, again, cultural and gender norms.
And also, I think it also comes down to game type. You know, you don't need a deep story or a deep character for an action game or a first-person shooter. You could get away with... the medic is a crazy German guy from Nazi Germany. I mean, that's not exactly deep storytelling. That doesn't really tell you a lot about his character outside of that he may have performed some inhumane experiments. And that is teammates better watch out for their organs being taken.
Oh. Team Fortress 2. Yeah, male characters though that are actually well written do add so much to a story though. I mean, male and female characters, but when you actually get a well-written character, it adds so much to the story.
Yeah, but once again, we come all the way back around to you are praising a game for having believable characters. And I think that's the crux of this problem, is that the storytelling has become lazy.
Yeah, totally. I mean, games that I can think of that have believable characters right off the top of my head, Life is Strange, and then like a huge wall flies up.
I would say maybe some of the characters in Fallout New Vegas jump to mind because Obsidian does really well with their character writing.
Yeah.
Now, not all of them, of course, far from that, but some of them definitely.
Stories with well-written characters.
Let's go to my
Probably.
Steam library and go to the RPG section
Well,
because
probably
that's.
t Tales from the Borderlands. Not all the Telltale games have well-written characters, but The Walking Dead, the first Walking Dead, and Tales from the Borderlands both have very well-written characters.
I think I kind of looked over the characters in The Walking Dead, partly because I was annoyed by the illusion of choice when they were selling the choices so much in that game.
Yeah, the first
It was
Walking
so
Dead.
apparent the illusion of choice in that.
The first Walking Dead had really realistic and believable characters. The second one, not so much. They all get a little bit stupid. What other games? I feel
How
like
about the
Knights.
relationship between the two brothers in Brothers: A Tale of Two Sons?
That's a good. Yeah, that's a well-written story with good characters.
Without a single intelligible word.
Yeah, those are very good characters. I think Halo, actually, the earlier games had some very, very well-written characters. The first three Halo games. The relationship between the Master Chief and Cortana is one of the best, most underrated love stories that I've ever seen in a game. Just the relationship that they share is one of that, at first glance, is something that you would miss, but there's very deep, deep love between them. That makes them extremely well-written characters.
Yeah, I'm just
But that's not all the characters, it's just those two.
yeah, I'm quickly going through my list and nothing really is jumping out, so I think it's coming back to the problem of writing in general.
Yeah, I could probably think of a smattering of other games that had like a couple of decent
Yeah, if we sat down
characters.
and really thought about it, but we're
Yeah.
trying to, yeah, not spend too much time on this.
Right. Let's move on to the tweets.
Okay, let's. B-Lug has a barrage of tweets that I'm just going to read off the first couple of rapid fire. Then we have a couple that may be more discussion triggering.
Okay.
All right. For those interested about World War Bay's territories on Eve, he shared a link, which will be in the show notes. I'm not sure how old this world map is now. It's but showing the different territories and the paths of travel for Eve. Did you see that?
Yeah, I've seen that. It's still fairly accurate.
Okay, except for the Goon Squad lost a bit of territory recently.
Yeah, but it's still not a lot. I mean, they gave up plenty of systems, but on the overall map, they didn't give up too much.
Okay, and he had a tweet to you saying, "I'm at the alcohol processing processing calculation, and you are wrong. The more alcohol you take, the slower it processes."
That's fair. I've been wrong before.
And to be fair, you are also very drunk at that point, I think.
I was drunk. I was remembering
Yeah,
a thing that I read one time several years ago. So.
and I have a feeling if we ever do that drinking game again, you're going to remove a rule that I abused.
Yeah, probably.
Even though it was fun. Or you just won't drink double shots.
I probably won't drink double shots, and also I won't drink when I'm like just sitting there quietly. I'll just make a conscientious effort to not just like keep drinking.
Or you'll just say fuck and then drink.
So, yeah. So what's next? Are these okay. next ones?
B-log. When I say sexist, it's defined about the fact that female characters are not treated equal to masculine characters. And for, well, I'm going to combine these two tweets. And for Honeycam, it's terrible. Just because the reason of the, because of the reasons of the girls do cam. Not like any job pay, not as much as their assets. So what do you think about that?
Okay, the first one, sexist being women not treated equal to men. I think that goes to your definition of sexism. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm not going to say that that's wrong. That's essentially the heart of what sexism is, although we tend to allow a certain degree of sexism culturally before it actually becomes sexist. So I don't want to say it's a narrow view of sexism. But I mean, that is basically the definition of sexism. So I would like some examples before I really start like knocking on it one way or another. But I don't really think that...
homework for next week, I guess, for B-log.
Yeah. I mean, I don't really think that that's too controversial of opinion. Again, like we said, sexism and opinions on sex in video games and most forms of media is very personal and relative to, you know, you as a person, the circumstances you grew up in, your culture, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So without more, I'm not willing to say, like, I don't think, you know, I don't, you know, I'm not willing to say I disagree with you. I'm not willing to say that you're wrong or that I believe that you're wrong. I mean, that is the definition of sexism. So depending on how you're using it would be where I would go from here. And what was the tweet about Honeycam?
The second one was talking about how Honeycam is terrible just because of the reasons that the girls do the cam, which I think that more comes down to how you view sex and also how do you view people using their own bodies. Is it is it causing sexism to use your body in a way to exploit men? Or exploit the views that some men have about the female form.
Yeah, I don't...
I think it really comes down to just how you view sex personally.
Well, directly answering the question of Honeycam, or the question that you raised, you think that it's bad because of the reasons that the girls do cam. There are a bunch of different reasons that the girls do cam. Like, there's one who used to be a porn star, and she's getting older and her, you know, she's losing her fans, so she wants to try something new. There's a girl who does it because she's just bored and is looking for something better to do. There are girls who want to use it to further another career. There's a whole bunch of different reasons that the girls like say that they do it when you look at their bio or talk to them for the first time.
I was talking about more of the real life reasons, or, you know, how people view a fact of sex. Is it slut shaming? Trying to think of a better way to put it. Is slut shaming sexist, or is someone exploiting their sexiness or their potential sexiness causing sexism because you're perpetuating the status quo? And it really comes down to the just how you view sex. That's where I was going with it.
Right. That's a difficult question. Right. It comes down to how you view sex and what you think people should or shouldn't do with their bodies.
Yeah, well, you're going to say it a lot more intelligently than I am.
You know, I don't have a problem with anybody doing anything with their body for any reason, unless it's to hurt or manipulate other people. So if your intent, like if your deep intent is to manipulate and control another person or group of people by using your body, I think that that's wrong. I'm not sure how sexist that becomes as opposed to just pure maliciousness. If you are using your natural born advantages, which if you're a person who's doing cam work because you have an attractive body that appeals to a certain group of people, I don't think that that's sexist. That's just making the best use of what you have been given naturally from birth. That's like saying that someone who is really strong and goes into a manual labor job like carpentry is somehow perpetuating the status quo for strong people.
Yeah, that's just the way I'm taking this, how he's talking about it. I could be misreading this.
Yeah, I was trying to kind of take it more at face value that he was saying that the reasons that the girls in the game do cam are kind of sexist. I think it's still the same argument. It's how you feel about what people do with their own bodies. But again, I could, it's a tweet. I could be misinterpreting, misreading.
Twitter is terrible about conveying ideas like this because you are so limited.
Right. So, I mean, based on the information that's been given and my interpretation of what he has said, I don't have a problem with any of the things that any of the reasons the girls do cam in the game, because none of them I feel like are to do harm to other people or to do harm to themselves.
Yeah, now if someone was being exploited into doing it.
As far as I know, there's nobody in the game that does that. I have not read every single character's bio, so there could be one of them that is being exploited. But I mean, I've read like 2/3 of their bios, and they all have legitimate reasons for doing it. So, I mean, I will take some time to look at it later and would be open to any more tweets or emails that come in to talk about it. But at this moment, I don't know of any of the things that they do that are sexist or are, hurtful to them or other people. So, yeah.
And I was right, that
Sexism.
did cause some discussion.
Yeah, it did.
Shall we
Sexism, an
carry on?
interesting and deep topic. Yeah,
Yeah, I think
let's.
that would be a lot better for an email, though. But I
Yeah.
wanted to dig that up because he did tweet that out pretty much immediately after the podcast went live, within a
Yeah.
few hours, so.
I would love to have a letter from you, B-Lug, where you go into that a bit more in depth, unless I got it right, in which case, you just being like, yeah, you got what I was saying. I mean, that's good enough. But feel free to expound on that as much as possible. I would love to continue to discuss this line of topic and questioning.
Yeah, and I think we covered kind of both aspects because I was going more general area and you were going very just where the game was.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's get to something lighter. Kyle. Haha, I don't swear that much. I'm against censorship. I don't look into the laws overseas. Mea culpa. He's causing me to say Latin now and butchering it, I think.
Would that be
Although
mea culpa?
agreeathon,
Mea culpa?
hell if I know.
I don't know. I don't speak Latin
It's
either.
Greek to me.
But tss.
Then let's see. I'm pretty much grabbing all the tweets because originally I thought we were going to go short, but I didn't filter these, so we're just going to do all of them anyway.
Okay.
Andrew Mason, he didn't tweet directly to the podcast's Twitter, but I grabbed it anyway. He just finished up episode 5 of the podcast, and he remembers from long ago about a keyless keyboard, and the keyboard was projected. And I remember that briefly. It was lasers, I believe.
Yeah, it was like infrared lasers or I
Yeah,
don't know,
and
something.
yeah, I think it was lasers made the outline, and infrared it was projecting on the keys, and if it detected you breaking the beam. At a certain point, it would cause the key to press, and I don't think it worked all that well.
I don't know. I've never tried it. I always like, there's no way
I
this
remember a lot
works.
of weird keyboards. Probably my favorite weird keyboard that I would love to have, but it would have been completely useless to me because I'm a touch typist, was the one that had all the keys were OLEDs. OLEDs, and this was back when OLEDs were very, very, very expensive.
Yeah.
It would have
I
been
liked.
completely useless, but it would have been fine.
They were horrible,
Yeah, it was something
but.
like under 20 FPS. I want to say something like 12 FPS was the most that they would support. And it was a horrible system drain as well.
Yeah. My favorite awful keyboard were like the smushy roll-up ones, just 'cause like they felt really nice on your fingers and your hand. They were awful to type on. They half the time didn't detect what key you were pressing, and the other half of the time like they just stayed on the whole time. Like, you're just smashing the key.
Well, there was also another type of keyboard, and I'm blanking on the name of it completely, but it was basically like the Enterprise, where it was a flat panel, and it was a complete touch LED, or LCD, I should say, not LED. It projected the keyboard, but it also had the ability to, play a video on the side and change the layout of the keyboard for whatever you want. But the problem with it is that there's no touch feedback, so you can't find the home keys by just putting your hands on it.
Yeah, that's interesting.
It's a gimmick.
I like that, actually, on the full-size iPads. I can actually use a full-size iPad like a keyboard. I was always really good at typing on one without the home keys. I don't know. It took a little bit of practice to get it down, but I got it pretty quickly.
And let's see, we have three from Supe.
Supe.
So, Jared, am I guessing right that the Schlongs of Skyrim is the first mod you installed? Immersion.
I have put dicks in Skyrim before.
Yeah, let's see. Jared, my earliest memory is Donkey Kong 2 on the Atari 2600, along with Atlantis Centipede, Keystone Capers, and others.
Nice. All good games I'm familiar with. That was 2. What's number 3?
And number 3 is, I really hope you didn't play Eve after the drinking episode. I've had plenty of oops moments when waking up.
After the drinking episode, I did go and play Eve. Thankfully, I was smart enough to go get in a ship that it was okay if it got blown up.
And you pretty much sat there for a half an hour, didn't you?
I sat there for a long time and didn't do anything. Like, I wandered out into space, I did some stuff, and then I wound up just sitting there talking to you, and then like a half an hour later, I was like, oh shit, I've been sitting here for a half an hour.
Yeah, you got really talkative after the show ended. I'm kind of disappointed that I rushed through the end of the show that quickly.
Yeah, the alcohol
because really... At first I thought you were fading fast, and you hit your second wind.
Yeah. I mean, we'll do it again sometime in the future. Maybe I'll just drink heavily, and then we'll just talk. Like, I'll pregame. We'll start the show when I'm, like, just starting to get drunk, and then I'll keep drinking throughout the show.
Then I need the TeamViewer ability to save the podcast remotely.
Yeah, you'll really have to be the designated podcaster on that one, and, like, direct me around. But I would totally do that. Fully drunken podcasting. Okay, are those all the tweets, or are there more?
Yeah, that's all. Supe ended us on the community corner.
Supe! Okay, so are you ready to discuss our weekly deals?
Yep.
Alrighty, how many weekly deals of the week did you come up with, Rach?
I came up with 2.
I also had 2.
Okay, so let's have you go first.
Okie dokie, my first game was Genesis Rising. This is a game that released in 2007. It is 75% off at $1.24, and don't let the Steam mostly negative reviews bother you. When this game first released on Steam, it had some awful, awful bugs that most of the time the game wouldn't launch, and if it did launch, you couldn't get past the second mission, it would just crash. But they have subsequently been fixed. And for some reason, if you still have issues, there are a number of dedicated players in the forums with fixes and places where you can go get them. Genesis Rising is a very, very pretty game for the fact that it was released in 2007. And it is kind of the next evolution in the homeworld thinking of game design. So in Homeworld, whenever you play the story, your fleet grows and persists over time. And that happens in Genesis Rising as well. But Genesis Rising gives you a number of mission choices and different ways which you can play through the game. It's not, there aren't many, many multiple endings, but there are different conversation choices you can make when talking to the other main characters in the game. There are branching story paths, and you can go back and revisit previous mission areas because certain events will happen in them, and you can go back to them to get new resources or handle problems before they get out of hand. So it's got a bit of universe world building to it. And on top of that, it's just a really good, solid game with a nice, well-thought-out difficulty curve. So all, not all, but most of the negative reviews are for the broken issues, the technical issues, which have been resolved. So at $1.25, this is a steal of a good deal.
A steal of a deal.
Steal of a deal.
Okay, well, shall I dig into the next one?
You shall dig into the next one.
Okay, and I am making a pun with that one because...
I was about to say, are you making a pun?
Yes, with SteamWorld Dig.
Nice.
A game that I recently played on the channel, Gaming with Caffeine Rage. Ding.
Ding.
This is a odd mixture of games. It's kind of Metroidvania, where you're as you progress, you gain new abilities and are able to do go to areas that you couldn't otherwise do previously. But it's also a mining game. It has essentially two areas to it. It has static mines in it, where they're essentially puzzle platformers with a bit of Metroidvania thrown in once again, because there are some things that you have to, that you can't get to without a certain power. You know, like you can't get to one area until you double jump, for example, or have a super jump ability. But then the overworld, or the connecting world to it, is this giant mine shaft that you have to continuously dig down through. And that is procedurally generated, and the ore in it is randomly placed. So you have to hunt around to find the ore to be able to have the money to upgrade yourself. And also hidden throughout the world are orbs, which is also... they kind of act a little bit like a premium currency, because you need the money and the orbs, but there's no way to buy them in the game. So it's just the way that you're handling it, instead of it buying power, you know, like a mobile game would. But right. it's an interesting game. It's a little short. It runs about 4 to 5 hours, and there's not a lot of replayability unless you're a mining nut like my co-host here.
Aw, yeah.
And it has some interesting puzzles on it. There, as you progress down, you encounter more enemies in the overworld and in the mines, and different types of enemies. You have more ranged enemies. You have ones that just wander around. Then you have ones that are just literally suicide bombers. And then there's death lasers, because of course there are.
Of course.
But the thing about this game is that while it's short, it doesn't feel like a grind going through it, like you would expect a mining game would. Because that is what it is at the heart of this game, is you're digging down to access the next mine, the next puzzle area. Right. But it doesn't feel that grindy. It feels almost like a puzzle game getting to the next puzzle, because you have to figure out where it is in the shaft, but you also have to figure out how to get there, because there's... hazards in the overworld. There's lasers. There's blocks that'll drip poison that'll hurt you when you touch them. Things that as you approach them, they'll throw up a barrier, and you have to either just jump through the barrier and take damage, or figure out a way around them. And it's an interesting take on the mining genre, which is a bit of a subgenre, you know, the mining grinding genre. I'm sure you know that genre, right?
What's that genre you're talking about? I've never heard of it.
Yeah, it's very popular in some web games, in some browser-based games. And that's what this feels like at first, until you dive into a lot more of the platformer aspects. I've done a complete playthrough of the game, and like I said, it took me, I think, about 4 hours, 4.5 hours.
Yeah.
And... it never felt like it was too difficult for me. It had a nice, slow, steady curve on its difficulty scale. It was a very enjoyable experience. And it is currently 50% off, which brings it down from its usual price of $9.99 to $4.99. And it does have a soundtrack available, which it does have an amazing soundtrack, but unfortunately it's not for sale, or not on sale, I should say. It is for sale, but it's not on sale. And it's 99 cents. If you like a short platformer that does do its theme justice. You know, unlike the platformer that I talked about, what, 3.5 hours ago, assuming editing.
Yeah.
This is a lot better than that one. Oh, and I should say that this the style of it is steampunk western, steampunks robots in the U.S. West, Old West.
It looks like a good game, and it's one that's definitely on my list to play at some point in the future. I don't know if I'm gonna buy it right now because of something that we talked about earlier before the show even started that I'm going to buy, but it's up there. I just like while you were talking about it, I just had an oh shit moment for another game.
What?
This is not my other recommendation. Let me go ahead and do my other recommendation, and then I'll talk about this real quick.
Okay.
Okay, so my other recommendation is Gemini Wars, which is a space RTS game.
Gee, I never heard this genre from you.
This is a
Who
bit
are you?
more of a standard real-time strategy. It's I mean really it's just an RTS with a space theme on it. There's only a 2D plane for fighting. There are warping and jumping and like a tiny bit of exploration that can be done inside the levels. You can colonize planets and build asteroid bases and stuff like that. And if you explore around a little bit, you can find things that are not shown up on the map and use them to give yourself some extra resources or like a hidden base or something like that. But for the most part, it's just a pretty much straight up standard RTS with some pretty basic rock, paper, scissors mechanics, to be honest, and like what ship type beats what other ship type. But it is a pretty fun and challenging campaign. And it's got a pretty decent story. It's not related to Starpoint Gemini, although they are produced by the same parent company, but they're not in the same universe. It is currently 80% off for $2.99. It also has mostly negative reviews. I'm not sure why a lot of people are saying that the game is boring, and that it does have some tech issues. I have not ever experienced any bugs or, well, no major bugs like crashing or anything like some people are talking about. So it could be a your mileage may vary. I think most of the negative reviews are coming from the fact that it is a pretty generic space RTS. So if you're not looking for a generic space RTS, it's not for you. But if you'd like a good RTS to play in like the interim, say, between two games, this would be a good one to pick up for $3. So now I said that it's not related to Starpoint Gemini, and this is where I had my oh shit moment. But it's produced by the same parent company. While you were talking, I was just like browsing through some of their games. I discovered a game called Starpoint Gemini Warlords, which I'm not saying that I created this game, but back when I used to do game reviews, I was a huge fan of Starpoint Gemini. I was very loud about the fact that I really liked the game and compared it heavily to Freelancer. And so the developers reached out to me a long time ago when Starpoint Gemini 2 was still in alpha. I got an extremely early build of the game, played it at length, did two in-depth reviews about it and a developer interview. And we were speaking about ideas for a future game. Like I was actually having a Skype conversation with them. And I pitched them the idea for this game. I didn't call it Warlords, but I'm going through like reading what this game is, and I'm like, that was my idea. That was my idea. That was my idea. And not that like obviously I have not developed this game. I'm not trying to steal any credit for it, but just like
But you do want the money.
I yeah, sure, I'll take the money. I mean, I'm not like gonna do anything crazy, like go sue them, like even I don't even have a legal case to stand on. Like I have no real proof of that. It's just like I know it happened, and I pitched them a whole bunch of these ideas, and they were like, "Oh yeah, those are all really like good ideas. We'll keep them in mind for future game development." And here they are. Apparently, it releases on early access in April, and you bet your ass I'm buying that because it's April. Actually, I'm going to contact them and see if I can get a copy of the game for free.
Well,
I am.
remember your friend.
I'll see if I can get a couple of copies. It looks like this is a multiplayer game. It's not an MMO, but it's community. I don't know. I'm not 100% sure. I'll have to
Community
read through all
driven,
this
so it's
stuff.
Eve.
Nah, I don't think so. Because it's saying it's got a campaign mode and a conquest mode, like offline stuff. But yeah, I'm excited. I'm excited about this. That's way off the topic of my game recommendations, but I'm really excited about this now. But yeah, those were my two.
Yeah, but remember, don't pre-order.
Well, I mean, I'm not going to pre-order. I'm just going to buy it on early access or try and get a free version. See if I can, if some of the old devs are still there, I can call in a favor. I got my wife put into Starpoint Gemini 2.
Wow.
She's actually in the game as one of the characters. She's the Red Queen. So if you've ever played Starpoint Gemini 2 and you find the character called the Red Queen, that is my wife. I think
I think for this one, you need to try to get your son in as the Red Prince. Or the Red King.
The Red King. They were like, we'll put a character in the game for you. Who do you want? And I pitched them this idea for a character, and they were like, oh, wow, yeah, that's really cool. The only thing that they got wrong was, I don't know who miscommunicated, but the Red Queen was supposed to be a carrier commander, and she is in command of a cruiser in the game.
Yeah.
Otherwise, like, I wrote the bio, I gave them the photos to use to create the character, and everything. So, yeah, my wife is in a video game.
Yeah, but she had to transfer a command.
And she couldn't give two shits that she's in a video game. I'm the one who's excited about that. She's like, oh, yeah, I guess that's neat. It's like, you're in a video game that's really popular. A lot of people have seen you, and they don't even know it. She's like, I don't really care. But I digress very heavily. I digressed off of a digression. Actually, I digressed off of a digression off of a digression.
Digressions all the way down.
So, if that's our Steam recommendations.
I still have my second one.
Oh, that's right. I went first this time, so you have your second one. Go ahead. Do your second one.
Yeah, if I knew you were going to digress that far, I would have gone first.
Well, I mean, I didn't know. I didn't discover this until just now.
Okay, well, I'm going to recommend a Clay game, even though I'm going to say that their entire library is worth it. I just wanted to pick one, so I would pick the one that I've had the most time with. Mark of the Ninja.
Mark of the Ninja.
The special edition is the one that's on sale. It's a bundle with the DLC, but the DLC is also on sale.
Okay.
Mark of the Ninja is a stealth platformer, and I'm not exactly the stealthy guy, but this makes me feel like a badass. You are a ninja that is sent on a mission. I don't remember a lot of the story, and I didn't play all the way through it, so I still need to go back and play it at some point. But essentially, you're given tattoos that give you superhuman abilities, but they're also going to kill you eventually. So, that's kind of the idea that it's a suicide mission, essentially. And you're sent into just these absurdly complex levels. It's pretty quick to die. Your time to death is very, very quick, I should say. So you do have to use stealth, but there's a lot of tricks that you can do. And you can go back and replay the previous levels, I believe, with your new equipment. So if you want to try to get up on the high score list, which I do believe that this has a leaderboard on it. Or just for bragging rights, that does offer the option. And there's a few ways to tackle most of the problems in the game. It's not completely open, problems. There are a lot of linear areas as well. But you're given some options, which I do enjoy. You're taking a look at it now?
Yeah, I'm looking at it right now.
It does have a very good art style, huh?
It is a very, very pretty art style. I'm trying to think of anything that reminds me of, but really I'm drawing a blank. It just...
Yeah, Clay's style is that they're unique. Every single one of their games is unique. Their other game that was on the weekly sale list that I saw was Invisible Ink, which is a terrible, glorious pun. but it also is a very unique in its art style. But I'm just going to say Clay games in general for this pick, kinda, but with the focus on Mark of the Ninja because I think it's my favorite out of their lineup.
Invisible Ink is on my wish list. Mark of the Ninja isn't because it's a 2D, game, but Invisible Ink is.
Yeah, but Terraria is slowly breaking you with that, isn't it?
Nah, Terraria is breaking free and becoming a game that I like. It's not breaking me into the genre. I mean, it looks neat, and I probably would play it if like someone gave it to me, or I would impulse buy it for like a dollar.
Yeah, but it does have a few interesting things it does. For one is that it visualizes sound very well. Whenever a guard takes a step, I'm not sure if the screenshots on the
They show like the little
circles.
Yeah, they show those.
Yeah, that's the range. So if you break a window, I believe you can break a window in this. I may be mixing it up with other stealth games because it's been a while. But every action that you take that creates sound generates a circle, and anything in that circle hears that action, which you could use to your advantage if you have certain equipment. Like if you have firecrackers, for example, yeah, you could throw them out. Well, they're called noisemakers, but yeah, same thing. You throw it out and it creates a sound to distract a guard, so you can turn sneak up behind him and ram your sword up his ass.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, turn him into a human corn dog.
All right. Whatever floats your boat, I guess.
Well, it's just the art style is really satisfying. It's nice to look at. The sound design isn't amazing, but I do recall it has a pretty good soundtrack. Not amazing, but pretty good. But more importantly, it has the gameplay to back it up. And after my disappointment for the week, you know, it's nice to have that.
Right.
And clay games in general, if you're a fan of the genre, you're going to enjoy their game. I think that's pretty much a good statement, at least so far.
Right.
And that does wrap us up for our weekly picks.
Yes, it does. In other news, back to Starport Gemini Warlords, it is EVE Online. They have Titans.
Did I say the price of... No, I don't think I did. The complete pack, that's the actual sale, is normally $16.63. It's 67% off, which brings it down to $5.93. And like I said, the DLC, which doesn't add a ton, it adds an extra level, a few tools. And I think the new level, you play a different character, but I could be mistaken on that. It's usually $5. It's 67% off, which brings it down to $1.64. Oh, and it also has the developer commentary. That's probably the big thing on that. So if you like developer commentary and want to spend $1.60, it's probably worth it for that.
Yeah.
Okay, now I'm done. Sorry, I just realized I didn't say the price.
It's okay. I didn't catch it because I was looking at the Steam page, and so I saw the price. Otherwise, I would have said, hey, you didn't say the price. So are you ready to plug your stuff?
Oh, my. Well, I've been doing it all evening.
That's fair enough. What can people expect on your channel this week, Rach?
Well, I literally just started today when we're recording the first episode of Stone Tales. That's going to go for a couple weeks at least. The rather disappointing, primitive cave painting platformer. Then, of course, there's... Darksiders and Terraria as well, rounding out my Let's Play titles, with the podcast obviously coming out on Fridays and the Sunday Sampler coming out on Sundays, which I still have no idea what it's going to be. I don't really figure that out until about Wednesday or Thursday, usually.
Right.
And you can find all of that on Gaming with Caffeine Rage on YouTube, or you can see my tweets when I start ranting because a video file corrupted and it took me most of the evening to figure out how to delete it because it was crashing Windows Explorer when it was trying to discover it to delete it on my Twitter.
Fun times.
On my Twitter at Gaming with CR.
Right. Well, on my channel this week, which is a Gaming Psychologist, I'm going to be playing catch up. I've got three EVE Explain videos that are ready. I've got the podcast video, which is ready.
You didn't even get the podcast video out? Wow, I didn't even realize that.
I didn't get it put up in time. Normally, I put it up Thursday night. I'll upload it Thursday night and get it ready to go for Friday. But
well, also, there's my views are down on the podcast video, but I think that's because the RSS feed behaved itself this week.
Right. But so, yeah, I haven't even gotten the podcast video uploaded yet. I mean, it's ready. It just is not uploaded. Let's see. I've got two other videos that I need to upload.
How many Terraria?
I've got a couple of Terraria videos that need to be uploaded. I've got all of the editing done on everything. I did some good work this weekend. I just couldn't put it up. So,
well, you do know that they have a pill for that, right?
Touche. But so this week is going to be another week of catch up as I frantically put everything that didn't go out when it was supposed to up online. Basically frantically. Then the Eve Explained videos are going to get scheduled. And I'm looking, and I'm 100% serious. I'm going to buy Starpoint Gemini Warlords this week if I can't get a review key for it.
Assuming that it comes out this week.
It comes out the 14th, which is Wednesday.
Actually, it's Thursday.
It's Thursday, right, because we've rolled over into Tuesday. So it comes out on Thursday. I will try and record and put that up ASAP, but that might actually creep into next week. So, yeah, we're going to be doing catch-up. And then there's going
any
to be...
Any mustard?
Mustard and mayonnaise, too.
See, I'm more of a Miracle Whip guy.
But, so ketchup and Eve Explained videos, as well as a couple of other surprise videos that I haven't talked about yet.
Oh, my.
One of them is what I'm calling Psychology 101. This is a test video where that I just explain one of the basic things of psychology as just an educational video. It's about 5 minutes long. And if it does well, I will start doing more of them.
Actually, I saw a news article not too long ago. I'd probably have to go try to dig it up. That may interest you. It was the 50 most misused terms in psychology. I believe it was psychology that they were talking about.
That was interesting. Yeah, I'd be interested in that. But yeah, so there's that. And then I've got one more video that is another kind of personal video, but it's not the same as the other video. This is more just like, I talk about being a therapist all the time, and I've now put up a video that talks about like my struggles as a therapist, but I wanted to actually just share a little bit about the type of work that I do and what kind of schools of thought I follow. So that's going to be up this week as well sometime.
Tell me, is it true? Is a cigar sometimes just a cigar?
A cigar sometimes is just a cigar. Actually, I'll yeah, just a little tease. I actually am a pretty big subscriber to the psychoanalytic school of thought. Not classical Freudian psychology, but psychoanalytic theory has its roots in Freud's work. More of a very deep analytical style of work as opposed to emotion-focused therapy or cognitive-based therapy. It works really well for one-on-one clients and people who are highly educated.
Topic idea for you. The evolution of psychology since Freud, since Freud is kind of what the general populace knows as psychology.
Yeah, Freud is the foundation for what we know of modern psychology. There were psychologists before him, but he was the first one that took what was mostly just research and applied it to working with individuals. But yeah, that's something that I can work with. I pretty much could do that offhand with no notes. If it wasn't for the fact that the show was already so long, barring editing, I could do that right now.
Well, come on. When was the last time we broke the four-hour mark?
We just broke the four-hour mark on the recording.
Oh, I'm looking at the show timer. It's showing 3 hours, 47 minutes.
Yeah. About that, folks. You're going to hear that, but actually, in a part that's going to get cut where Rage and I discuss this, we're going to pull out a huge section of the show and keep that for a bonus episode or throw it in the reserve for when one of us has to be gone. So eventually you'll get the content. It's not something that's super time sensitive. So you'll get it.
Yeah, you'll just have to remember to make an intro for it.
Yeah.
Because we talk about it as a current event and not the history of it.
Yeah, that's true. But yeah, it's a topic that is fairly general. So in order to shave like 40 minutes off the podcast, we're going to pull it out. So you'll get it in the future. Don't worry.
And I'll it was sure somewhat interesting, at least to me.
I thought it was an interesting topic, but it's the topic that we can most pull out of the show. Or maybe Hardcore Henry. We might can pull that out, too. I don't know. We'll see.
We'll just delete the entire thing and start over.
Right. Let's just throw away 4 hours of recording.
Oh, trust me. I've thrown away hours of recording because of recording errors before. You know, nothing like silent footage to put a damper on a recording session.
Right. But there will this show will be closer to the 3 hour mark than the 4 hour mark. Don't worry.
In theory.
And I'll just keep you guessing as to what it's going to be, because I'm going to remove it from the news and everything.
Well, you'll probably have to tell me, because I'm making the show notes.
Yeah, I'll let you know once I do the editing. I'll have it edited probably by Wednesday night. Since it's a Monday, I'll get some time to work on it tomorrow and some time to work on it Wednesday.
Ooh, I'm not pulling overnighter to record the video.
Nope. But so yeah, that's what's coming up on my channel, Gaming Psychologist. And you can follow me on Twitter at JMA4707. You can follow me on Twitch at twitch.tv/JArthur4707. We are going to be doing some fun Twitch stuff. I'm just going to go ahead and say it. Tabletop Simulator is on sale. We're going to buy some Tabletop Simulator and start doing some, I don't know, board game stuff or like wacky stuff.
Yeah, I think we're going to have to figure out what board game to play.
Yeah.
There's a couple on the list that on the workshop that I've seen that I wanted to play.
Yeah, we can play many board games, but that's going to be coming in the near future. Probably not.
Hopefully it won't be board games.
Hey-o. Probably not this week, because we'll just get it and start learning how it works. I'd say it's fairly simple and intuitive, but I don't really want to try and learn it on a stream. But we'll see.
That's for the game itself.
Right.
And a lot of shouting, remember? Because it is a board game.
Right. A lot of shouting. Flipping the table.
There is the flip the table button.
So, yeah, that's what's coming up with me this week.
Are we ready to launch the Patreon? Because you were gone for the weekend, and I haven't touched the damn thing.
No, I don't think we're ready yet.
I've been toying around with ideas, which I actually have an idea for the logo that I've been doing a test image. I'm going to show you that after the show.
Sure.
And, I think you'll like it. The general idea of it, at least. It's not the final product, naturally. I was using a Twitter banner as an idea to just test a style.
Right. Well, our Patreon will be coming eventually. We're working on it.
And yeah, which we have talked about the first thing that we're going to do, right? The with the money. Assuming that we get money.
Yeah,
if we don't get money, it doesn't stop the show at all.
Right.
It's not a showstopper. It just improves the show. And the first thing we're going to do is better file hosting.
Right. We use a free solution right now, Internet Archive. They are amazing, and it works. But
they're also a bit slow, especially for file sizes of our size.
Yeah, it works, but they're slow.
We probably should throw them a donation.
Oh, yeah, definitely. If we get some money, I'm going to give them some money. Because they've hosted, 14, 15 episodes at roughly 100 megs apiece. So they've got over a gig of our stuff stored.
Yeah, and plus Internet Archive is awesome.
They are awesome.
They have all sorts of stuff, a lot of public domain stuff, a lot of the stuff that just it's hard to find elsewhere.
You know, we've never plugged them before, and I think we should. I think at least until we stop using them, if we get some donations, we should just start plugging them every episode.
Yeah, thank you, Internet Archive.
And we do apologize for not plugging you in the past. We will do double good to plug you in the future. Everybody, give your money to Internet Archive. Fuck us. Give them your money.
can I at least get dinner first?
Fair enough, but you don't have to buy me dinner. I'll fuck you for free.
Well, I am a cheap date, but I do like the company first.
Nah. Sex, please. I want the sex in my sex hole.
Well, I'll talk like this the entire time.
Oh, yeah. Let me get out my candles. And the bubble bath.
Just get out your candles, the wine. I won't drink it, most likely, but You could have all the wine you want.
Oh, yeah. Can I drink it off of your sexy body? Can I pour it in your navel and lick it out?
Oh, my.
As much as
so goodbye, child-friendly rating.
As much as I would love to continue this, I don't want to drive away any more of our listeners than we already have. So.
Yeah, we don't want to drop below dozens and dozens.
Yeah, so let's... Oh, speaking of numbers, I haven't checked on the numbers in like a week.
Yeah, well, while you do that, I'll say that if you do wish to contact us for some reason after that last little thing, you could reach us at our email, vglpodcast@gmail.com, with your letters or your voicemail or just your general disgust. Or just tweet us at VGL Podcast.
Yep.
And the website. Well, sorry, go ahead.
We're up to 402 downloads.
Wow.
For our episodes.
Yeah, it's been a slow week for this last episode, mostly because I think the RSS feed worked. Without me having to bang on it with the hammer. Why do you think the hammer was bloody?
Banging. You're banging on stuff.
No. And the RSS feed is at videogamelogicpodcast.blogspot.com, and it's also on iTunes.
Just search when for the RSS game feed logic. Works.
When the RSS feed works, of course.
Right.
One of these, maybe that will be. I think that's like our second or third thing is get better hosting for the website so the RSS feed works, or you know, figure out the black magic behind Blogger.
Right.
What are the two? Our intro and outro music is On the Ground by Kevin McLeod, and you can find his work at incomputech.com. And don't forget to check out the Internet Archive, because they are awesome.
Right. And as always, as his wonderful music starts to roll across my voice, bye-bye now.
Yeah, I'll see you next time.
Sink.
Pretty much on the money there.
Yep. What is that background? Oh, that's the washing machine. My mic is picking it up. Did I close the door? Yeah, I closed the door. I guess it's just a little bit off balance and it's vibrating or something. Weird.
Oh, my.
I don't know. It'll stop in a little bit, so it'll be fine.
Go in there, lean against it for a while.
Oh yeah. That was from, shit, what's the movie with John Candy in it?
Nice catch! The Great Outdoors.
There you go, Great Outdoors.
I can't believe you got that reference.
Of course I got that reference.
That movie is old for you.
Yes, it is. It came out before I was born.
Oh, John Candy.
I'm a goddamn old man.